really nice to see the number of you who got up on a Saturday morning after a lovely evening of our Christmas parade to be here, so thank you very much. This is a workshop, so it is not a formal city council meeting, which is why there's not an agenda. There are no directions or decisions to be made today. It is literally an informational session for not only council to ask questions, but for the community to ask questions and also to provide input. So we will go through the staff presenting the information, then council will be able to ask questions, and then we'll hand it over to the public for your questions and your input. So please share with us your thoughts, your concerns, and directions you'd like to see us take regarding the budget. And again, to council, this is an informational session, and we will not be making any decisions or directions to staff today. So with that being said, I will hand it over to our city manager, Mr. Jim Throop, for the day.
Thank you, Mayor and Council. It is on. As the mayor said, this is a workshop, and I was asking how many times have we done this. In my experience, what we've done and where I've been, anytime a new council is seated, we've always tried to present a quick current outlook of where we are in the city.
Mr. Troop, I need to interrupt you. Yes. Because I didn't get an email of our agenda, I didn't look in my box, so we need to stop and say the pledge for a moment.
Oh, I'm sorry.
That's okay. Please rise and join me in the pledge quickly.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
And let's do a quick roll call.
Councilmember Vega.
Here.
Councilmember Starbuck.
Present.
Councilmember Mosby.
Present.
Mayor Janelle Osborne.
Here. My apologies. I think making mistakes on the first run out is a good time to do it, so thank you all.
And it is casual, that's why I'm kind of high on it really is. This is I walk around too, so, okay, see if that works. So this is, you know, sort of the old fashioned way that cities used to bring people in, get the involvement from the community, and that's what we want to try and do here. Because as we've gotten, I've been here 5, going on 6 months, and working with our finance staff, trying to figure out where we are today, where'd we come from, what does next budget cycle look like? And then again, as I was saying, anytime a new council's seated, because sometimes you have brand new people, we will soon have another one, they need to know where we are, because the budget itself is going to kick off here very, very quickly. So again, the idea for this one is to say, here's where we were the last year or two, here's where this current budget that we're in looks like we're going to end in June, and then what does the nut look like, this big nut? And it's like I looked online and I was gonna give a little slide. There's the bigger than a coconut out there, and it's not a walnut. So we'll get through all of that. We did ask, I asked all the department heads to either they be here or bring extra staff. So when it comes time to council questions, community questions, we'll do everything we can to answer them, but just know that some of them might be too detailed. We won't have the answers immediately. If that's the case, we'll take the questions down. We can report back at the next council meeting with the answers. It's just trying to get this, and that, you know, that word that's been there for a number of years now is transparency, trying to get that out there and open. You'll see at the end something that Dean's worked up. It's a, I don't want to spoil it, but it's a really cool tool that I have never had before in 30 years. We're going to take and expand on it, but I'll get into that a little bit later. One of the things I think everyone has to try and understand, city finances are not like being at home. They're not like having your own business. We have to follow a whole set of rules that no one else does. And that's because we're not a business. We're a government here to serve the people and do different things. So the tax money that you have to pay your property taxes, you have to pay the water, you have to pay all these things. You don't get a choice saying, do I go to McDonald's? Am I going to go to Carl's Jr.? You're required to pay it. So with that, government had to set up all kinds of rules and regulations, because I'm sure you don't want me just calling up my Uncle Joey saying, hey, I got a street project over here. Why don't you go do the street for me? You want an open, honest government that goes through and gets the best prices to the best person, the best whatever. So from an operating as a business, it makes it very difficult because we have so many other rules. I just can't go in there and do things today. I have to present to my bosses, my five bosses, different things that go on. Then you get into the deeper part, and how do you account for all of it? And the one name you always hear us talk about is general fund. The general funds where the property, and we're going to go through this too, the general fund is your property tax, sales tax, hotel tax, all these different taxes and permits come in. The general fund, and that's the key one we focus on, that's the one that goes to parks, police, fire, pools, libraries, all of the services that go out there, but it also goes to the back of the shop, which is finance department, HR department, planning department, all the other ancillary that are sitting behind the walls there, but they are important and they are necessary. The other ones, and I'm going to summarize it because it's really much broader, I'll call them special revenue funds, or in this case, the enterprise funds. An enterprise fund is the water fund, sewer fund, trash fund, electrical fund, all these different funds. They are more business oriented, but again, we're different from a business because we don't charge a profit. We have to charge what is a reasonable price to provide that service, such as an electric. We can't go in there like PG&E and Edison and say, we're going to build in a 35% profit margin. We have to look at what does it cost to operate, what is our capital expenses, what are some other items in there, and then we have to come up with a rate that fits that. We no longer at any point get to say, oh, and add 10% more just because we want that. The other one that's important on that is you'll see during the budget cycle, not today, but during the budget cycle, someone might present, we have, and I don't know the number, but say $10 million in the water fund. Someone might say, take the $10 million, go spend it on Ryan Park, let's fix it. Again, unlike our home and my checking and savings account, they're linked, I can go spend it anywhere I want. The water fund that gets the water, spent on the water. Sewer funds, you can only spend it in those areas. You can't commingle them to other places, with the exception of the general fund. General fund's the only one that you can spend essentially anywhere in the city. So as we get into the budget cycle, those questions I know will come up if someone, they weren't here to hear what's going on, but we have to do what's called fund accounting. Money comes in, we have to put it in its own special fund, its own checking account, however you want to call it, and we can't commingle those. So I'm pointing that out because it's critical as we go through the presentation that you understand when you see general fund costs and other costs, we can't cross the lines. Can't, like in Ghostbusters, don't cross the streams. So there's all of that in the fine. I mean, I have a couple pages of talking about that one. So again, it's general fund is what we tend to focus on because that's the one that has much more fluctuation. We know what the rates are. They'll go up and down a little bit, but the general fund, during the last recession, property taxes just dropped, sales taxes dropped, all of these things dropped. They're much more of a variable property revenue stream. The rates, we know how much electric people are going to use. They might cut back a little. Water did get cut back a little during the drought, but we can budget for those. The last one, I don't know if we talked about, was if we can hold the questions until the end, except for my bosses, they get to ask as many as want, but if we can, even up here, hold the questions to the end, and we'll just sort of do it all at one time. And that's why I did have all the staff that I could get in here today to answer questions, because I may not know all the details. They're the experts. And lastly, so what we're going to be doing is we have Brad Wilkie as our management services director, the one with the tie, and I forgot to wear mine. And Dean Albro is our finance manager, and actually Dean's going to be the one presenting the slides today, and I'll be jumping in at the end, or you might have a tag team between the three of us. So before we get started, are there any other questions that we can just answer real quick here? No? No, I did that great. Okay.
First, I'd like to say thank you, everybody, for showing up on Saturday. I know it's your weekend. I also wanted to say that, you know, normally we like to get this to you guys ahead of time. We're currently installing a new software system, and we're also doing our financials and trying to get this together. But I wanted this to be as current as possible. We're still not done with our financials. We probably won't be done for another couple of weeks. So, hot off the press. Today I'd like to talk a little bit about the current economy, look at the general fund history, then we'll dig deep into the 2018 unaudited actuals, and then we'll talk a little bit about the 19 budget and the 1921 budget. So the economy so far has been doing really well. Unemployment numbers are really low. The housing market's starting to recover. We really don't see any housing bubble like we did. Stock market is doing, I did have great, but you know, lately it's been doing mediocre, so I'll put good. Auto sales are starting to go up. European market's starting to recover, and the wages are starting to go up too. So those are all some good signs. We do have some challenges, retirement obligations, especially here at the city where we're gonna see them for increases for probably 24 more years. That's a long time. We are seeing a lot of baby boomers that are retiring. We're gonna probably see a shortage of skilled labor. I think that's gonna be a little bit on the gross domestic product or GDP. And we're definitely seeing a shortage of houses, especially here in California, probably epidemic here in Santa Barbara County. And we're definitely having some challenges trying to build out Lompoc itself. Interest rates are going up. Are we seeing a market bubble? We're seeing something. I'm seeing some clouds, and you know, when the stimulus runs out, I'm a little bit concerned about what we're going to see probably about 2 years from now. I think we're good for the next 2 years, though. One of the things I like to look at when I'm analyzing interest rates is the Taylor Rule, and this was developed by Stanford University by Professor Taylor. And what it really does is it's a measure of how fast the economy is going. It does GDP, unemployment, inflation, and it is year over year, and it just sees how fast the market's going. And it's important to look at this, and matter of fact, there's a lot of debate between when Bernanke and Yellen were in power, whether this should be what they use to adjust the monetary policies. I agree with them. They said no. I don't think you make decisions based on a formula because things don't work in a vacuum. But when you see, we hit the wrong button. If you see the housing market, what happened between the two lines of actuals versus the Taylor Rule is the economy is going too fast and the feds didn't raise rates. And I think that was part of the problem with the housing, but there's a lot of other problems. But the reason why I bring this up is because if you look over here on the end where we are now, we're seeing the same split there. Matter of fact, you see the blue line at the end, that's the interest rates actually going up. As interest rates go up, and we've seen about 150 basis points or 1.5%, what that means for the city is about every 100 basis points, we see about $750,000 to $800,000 in earnings. And that helps a lot of the funds that have fund balance. For example, our utilities, it'll help against the unfunded accrued liabilities for our pensions. But it also helps special revenue funds, but it really isn't going to help the general fund much because there's not a big fund balance. Another thing I wanted to bring up on the global area is, or this is actually Lompoc, is we're seeing the price of houses go up. We're also, like I said, seeing interest rates go up. Keep in mind when you look at this graph, see that when the housing market started going up? 2012. I say that for a reason. I'll bring it up again. And also, it concerns me when I see rents going up almost $300 a month. That's $3,600 the average family is out of their budget, and that's a lot of money. So, but you know, that'll hurt us in sales tax, but we've been very fortunate so far. All right, so I'm gonna look back a little bit on the general fund history. This is my main concern when I think of the general fund. This is basically what we have left over in our checkbook to spend. It's the unassigned fund balance. And you look at 2018, we're almost out of money. You know, you look at our revenue stream, you think things are great. Look at that top sales one. That thing just straight up. All the other ones, property tax, like I said, 2012 it went up. If you look here, you see it, 2014 is when we actually saw that money. And there's a reason why, because when the county reassesses that piece of property, it can take them 6 to 8 months, depending on how far behind they are. And even then, when they adjust the roll, it takes almost a year to a year and a half before we actually see it in our CAFR. Or so it's a big delay. But the good thing is, we see the curve going upward. You go back and look at the property values, it's going upward. So property tax is probably going to be good and solid for the 19-21 budget. Problem, expenses. The main problem, pension expense. The unfunded accrued liabilities. I put this here. Brad was nice enough to put this together for me. And you see the top two lines, that's our unfunded pension liability going forward. I put the county in there because anytime you have a really big debt, there's an opportunity to save money, and that's to try and pay it off faster. The county did that. They went to a 15-year amortization. You can see right there where it drops down. They're going to have about a 40% less to 50%. Less cost for every employee. All right, so I'm going to spend a lot of time on the 2018 budget.
Dean, can we go back one real quick just to that last one?
Sure.
The other thing that's noticeable in that slide is the gap between where Santa Barbara is, Santa Barbara County, and our city, is that allows them to then either they could increase salaries, or they could increase hiring by whatever level, because they've dropped their cost for every employee substantially by paying that off sooner. So that's a benefit to them to be able to go out and attract more employees, either for just more employees or a richer benefit package to attract them or something else. So ours is going to continue out. As you can see, those top two lines continue out for quite some time.
Yeah, and if you look at where we are today, where that red line is, and you go across to where we'll actually be there again, that low, it's like 2037. It's a long time. I mean, got a long debt in front of us. Yeah, go ahead.
You know, watching the county's budget and how they've been going through, one of the ways they're affording to do this is they have a huge deferred maintenance.
Is that right?
Billions.
Yeah.
So that's how they're making the sacrifice to get this. Now, when that gets done, more than likely, they're going to spend a lot of that money.
Yeah, I think they're fixing, you know, 4 or 5 years, they're going to start seeing some difficulties too. But, you know, they'll be able to see the end of the tunnel, I hope, well, for them.
They got a couple $1 billion they're going to have to make up
for. They got
for
some trouble. They got some challenges in front of them. So where are we at? 2018, you'll see, I always like to look at our original budget. I like to look at it against where we are actually. I don't really like to look at revised budget because we can put anything we want and pass things. But how did we do when we had a balanced budget to where we are now? And if you look at the original budget, we started out with a $114,000 deficit. We ended up at $545,000. And if you go to the right, you'll see our variances. That's important. Really where our variance is in our revenue stream. And I'll go over that a little bit more. We actually did pretty well in staying within our appropriations on our expenditure side. Mm-hmm. And on the bottom, I always like to take one-time anomalies out, and so we actually see what it really is costing us to run the budget.
You spent to specify what, when we say FY18, 2018, the from what time period?
Oh yeah, that's from July 1, 2017 to June 2018, and that's what our fiscal year is, our cycle. If you look at our revenue stream, like I said, this is really where we missed it. I should have had that bottom one red. Anyways, if you look at the top three, that's our taxes. We really did pretty good with taxes. We did a pretty good estimate, and they came in a little bit higher. That's some good stuff that'll help us going forward in the future. That revenues from other agencies, that's a good thing too. That's grants coming in for police mainly. The next two, where we have the revenues for building permits and planning development, we missed that. We were expecting to have some build out. We just didn't have it. The $76,000 for the recreation, they did really good at holding their expenditures down, so that's really not an alarm. We didn't sell the one-time property that we were hoping to bridge the gap. And the streets and roads has an offset in the revenues, too. I'm not going to spend too much time on this slide because I'm going to drill down on this slide very heavily. But overall, when you look at this variance one, the black ones are good. The red ones are, we missed it. Don't get alarmed by the non-departmental. That's where we house our expected salary savings. If we don't get salary savings on all the plus sides, and we try to move it. We did it in June. So keep that in mind. We did go over a little in fire and overtime. But overall, we did pretty well. And like I said, we're going to drill down on this pretty heavily, and I'll get into each division. That being said, kind of wanted to get back to the basics, who pays for what the costs are. I brought this to you guys in April, called net expenditures. I think this is important. This is what it really costs the general fund to run these divisions. This is after I take out, after I take out all the user fees and grants and everything like that. This is what comes out of taxes. On the left side is our revenues. And basically, the general fund is ran by taxes. 50% of the revenues comes from property tax. Remember, I talked about how the revenue stream for that looks solid and it's going to go up. That's a good thing. The 22% side, the property tax in lieu of VLF, that everybody calls it, that's the vehicle license fee that we used to get in 04, and the state tried to do some swap things so they could try and balance their budget. But the most important thing is 50% of our budget in taxes is based upon the assessed valuations. And since we know those are going to be good numbers going forward, we're going to have some pretty good solid taxes, we hope. Well, hopefully sales tax. And we are seeing some good TOT tax and the other taxes as well. When you look at property tax, we don't get all the property tax. It's the 1% that is assessed on houses, we get 16.73%. So if you look on the right there, that's, you look at a current median house here in Lompoc at 350, 1% is 3,500. Our share of that to the Lompoc General Fund is about $585 per house. Kind of give you an idea if we were to build out 100 houses, how much we would get. These next slides are just to show you how we compare our revenue streams compared to other cities. You can see over there, we're on the left. We're one of the lower valuation houses, so we don't see as much as the other cities in the Tri-County. Same thing comes with TOT. We actually did a little bit better than I thought. I think that's because of Vandenberg. But this one shows you where we are with the sales tax. I mean, you see a lot of those, the blue and the green, that's the add-on tax, the transaction tax that have been voted on. Right now, currently 65.1% of all California cities approved an add-on tax to try and balance their budget because all the cities are seeing the same issue. You know, it makes it difficult when you see our revenue streams that, you know, and this kind of says loud and clear, you know, that the median income for the city of Lompoc is the bottom. Like I said, I'm going to go back to this. Keep in mind, like I said, when I talked about net, we're talking about the gross expenditures less the charge for services. And even if it's an administrative service charge, that's really a charge for service. And I'm also backing out grants, and I'm doing it by division. So if there's a police grant, I'm going to take it out of the police. And that gets our net cost or our discretionary, what needs to come out of discretionary funds. I broke this out into two categories when I went over these expenditures. This is the tax-supported ones, and engineering is a little bit of a hodgepodge between the two, but we got building, inspection, planning, library, rec, parks, and fire and police, and we'll go through each one of those. So this is the worksheet that I'm going to go through, all 16 of those divisions. You can see on the top, you got the expenditures. And below that, you'll see the revenues, and you'll see, like, when it comes to engineering, the revenue streams. And then you can see the net cost to the general fund. And each one is going to have the red pie over there on the right. That's going to be how much the percentage is of the general fund. And keep in mind, When I'm talking about engineering streets and urban forestry, that number is normally going to be about $400,000 or $500,000. This was just a unique year. We had a lot of, they did a lot more payments, almost $1 million. Last year was the net cost last year. So just keep that in mind when you're looking at the other numbers down here, like the cost to the general fund per employee. We need to multiply that by about 4 or 5 to get the continuing cost. But this is the actuals, what's in the budget this year. And like I said, it's because they paid so much last year, and we're trying to get a balance of what is the general fund's portion. So when we move on, building inspections. Our goal in building inspections is, you see in blue over there, charge for services. That's our cost recovery level. Our goal is to get that to 100. We just didn't see our build out that we want. Building inspection is very unique. They have a fixed cost. You know, the person at the counter's there, our inspector's there, our building official. So even if we build zero houses, we're going to have a cost of $532,000. So it's, and you can see what the building inspection and planning fees are for that division. And if you look at it, 41% came out of the general fund. That's about $49.7 thousand per employee for those 2.7 employees. Planning's the same way. We don't see a build out. The numbers in planning go up. It costs us $433,000 to run, $996,000 for the planning division. 59% of that came out of the general fund, with a cost per employee at $55,435. And like I said, if we saw more development, that number would go down. Library is a little unique. We get funding about 41% from Santa Barbara County to run the library. 49% comes out of ours. It's $1.2 million to run it, $630,000 we get from other divisions. We also get some, a little bit from charge for services. We get a good amount of contributions and a few grants. And that's about $36.5 per employee. Recreation, I wanted to point something out about the recreation. I'm gonna circle it there for you. When we passed our user fee schedule, our goal was to be 100% for our rec programs. If you look at the DeWeese and the revolving one at the bottom are the 197%. That's over 100% when you add them together. Good job, guys. And then doing 66% for a pool, that's a lot. That's good news. I think overall the average is like 25 for most cities. And our goal for most cities, the goal is 50% for charge for services or recovery. We did better than that. 47% was the general fund, and it cost us about $34,000 per employee. Excuse me. Parks division, definitely a fixed cost. 86% comes out of the general fund. Excuse me. $58,000 per employee. The fire division, it cost us $5.8 million almost to run the fire. 95.7% comes out of the general fund, a little bit from charge for services or inspections and a little bit of grants. That cost us $158,000 per employee. Oh, thank you. Excuse me. Police, 92%. We get 5% for grants and 3% for charge for services. Excuse me. There's two numbers there for per employee. There's the departments is 118. I also put what it costs for a sworn officer. It's a little bit more. We're a little bit lucky that there's more grants available for run police than fire. But it costs us a net cost of $9.2 million. This next division is what I call the support division. It's the general government. Everything in this division is they're pretty much doing it for another, for they're doing it for the whole city, citywide. Let me go back up. And each one of those has a different methodology on how they're allocated out to the other divisions. and I don't know all of them because there's like 40 of them, and some of them have so many of them, like finance, you wouldn't believe, but they all have, they all mean something. When we look at, let's say, city council, it's based upon city council action. So we go back, we look at how many staff reports went through, and we also count up how many people, and we also, so there's like three or four methodologies for just for city council, and like I said, like finance, there's like 25 methodologies. But if you look at the city council, 53.8% comes out of the general fund. We only have one employee, and it's allocated at 0.3, and that cost us $12,837. Administration has done a lot like council. It's council action. It's the number of staff, and then there's it's like I said, I don't know all of them, but I know that the bulk of it are those. And 28.5% comes out of the general fund. It costs us $80,000 to run that net, to run that division at 28.3 for each employee. The city attorney, this is based on legal action and council action. So 36.3% comes out of the general fund. Net cost of 158.9, 33.6 for each employee. We only have one employee in that division, but you can see the net cost too, what we charge out to the other divisions. And that's in everyone. You can go back and look at that. That's kind of the idea I wanted to do here, is give you guys working papers so you can figure out what things cost. City clerk, it's a lot like council. It's by council actions and storage. 31.4% general fund, $48,000 for those two per employee. Finance. Finance is kind of a unique one. I was surprised that it was 17.8. I thought it would have been lower. If you look at the people that are in finance, about 50% of them do almost 100% or close thereupon to the industry's enterprise. An example is I like to use is utility billing. I mean, their whole job is really to collect utility bills. Treasury, you know, is in there too, but they do tax processing and other things for the general fund as well. Like I said, 17.8 was the general fund cost, and it costs like $14,600 for per employee. Human resources, they're done by how many people are in the city in the general fund. There's more, and also what action they do. So they get a little bit bigger portion of the general fund at 51.9%. Their net cost is $272. About $48,000 per employee. Economic development is allocated the same way as admin, 28.5 general fund, about 29.5 for every employee. And I wasn't surprised facilities was in the 50%, 51%. Even though they're probably one of the most complicated ones because they do stuff for everybody, and then you have to go, okay, they did this for this, and then that one gets this, and then that one gets that. It's a never-ending circle. But they're 35.5 per employee. So if we look at where we are, and these are definitely preliminary numbers, we were having trouble getting our sales tax data because they put new systems in, and we know our property tax numbers, but we're seeing a lot of ups and downs. We're trying to hold as many vacancies as we can. We're still a little over on the overtime for fire. Overall, we're about 100,000 to the good, a little less. I'm still holding to my prediction and my forecast model. I adjusted a little bit, but you can see what I've been predicting. I think I've been doing this for the last 4 years, and it really hasn't changed any. The only thing that changes, CalPERS keeps changing their assumptions and making it worse. This is my prediction for the 1921. It's pretty much in line with our service levels from the current budget, and it came to fruition through the process. We've been trying to hold, like I said, vacancies and cut costs, try and balance the budget, but this is about where we are. And I'm going to turn it over to our city manager. Thank you, guys.
Okay.
So this one, you look at it and you go, okay, there's bar graphs, there's lines, there's how is this really looking? So if I can do this right. So in our expense line item, you know, you can definitely see the increases are going up. And that happens a lot of times, just inflationary costs, but we also have outside forces hitting us from CalPERS, there's insurance costs, general liability, there's just other things that aren't within the realm that we can control and say, no, we're not gonna pay that. They come from the outside. Our revenue stream here is the blue bars. Those are also, we're not a private company, so the more marketing we do, in a sense, we can't drive property taxes to go up. We could maybe work on sales tax, but because it's not city that we're marketing per se, would have to be all the businesses out there. So we'd have to market the city as a reason to come here, and then they would feed out to the businesses. So that's a tough one to do. What's a little concerning to me is this is our reserve line item. And so as these gaps between the two continue to either grow or just be sustained, that's driving a bigger and bigger deficit because it's just compounding upon itself. So as you know, without making changes, just saying status quo, don't do anything, which nobody would ever do. No council would ever just say, stay the course when you know you're in a position. But from a forecasting, you have to see what's going on. It's not a good point. You know, there's no way when we say $14 million negative deficit or negative reserves, you can't do that. I can't keep throwing out a credit card and spending it. So this says a lot. It's something we have to look at and understand. What this says, though, too, this is where we're talking about, you know, so it's like the Charles Dickens Christmas story. There we were, here we are, and here's where we're going to go. And we're seeing, you know, ghost of future to come. This is where we're starting off as a status quo. If we don't do anything else, we don't change. We know there's a CalPERS increase in there. We know some other pieces that are in there, but we haven't done anything. We're keeping the same levels of staffing and whatnot. But we also have more outside influences coming in that we have to do something about. So that 3.4, you add another $1.2 million, you're talking $5 million, $5 million deficit that we have to do something, because no one here, I can't balance my budget and say, hey, I'm gonna go spend more when I'm not making it. So things that are coming through that will have to be part of the budget discussion, whether these all make it in, they don't make it in, something will have to happen, but some of them will have to happen. Like the riverbed patrol and cleanup, that's a combination of costs. So we're looking, our estimate right now is about $520,000. That's for patrolling, continued cleanup of literally the cleanup of trash, the cleaning up of the coyote brush and everything else, because we can't let it get back to that point where it becomes a place for people to inhabit very easily. The old pool building, I've heard from different people, inside, outside, what are we gonna do with it? We do have some funds available, but the cost is a little bit more than what we have set aside for it. So we need about $200,000 more, which is what that number is, to go through and remove it. I like to think outside the box, be creative, and the one I've told some of the council, I've told some of the staff, is to clean it out, get rid of any of the hazardous, if there's any asbestous, we'd have to do all that. But I said, offer it up to like a film crew that can come in and use it for a movie, that they can burn it, blow it up, do something, because we're gonna have to get rid of it eventually. And it's sort of like Sideways. People know Lompoc from Sideways, they know different things. So it's just, when I was up in Paso, the city has a Quonset hut that was in Steve Martin's Blue Moon, one of his movies, I've forgotten. People know about it, so it's just something we can look at. The general liability, that's coming up. We can't stop that one, that's coming. We're building a new transit center, and with the fleet department, they've maxed out where they are, so we're gonna move either all or a portion. I'll have to look for Dirk and see what he says, but that, moving it over, is we have to then pay a rent for the new transit facility, and it was designed that way. But it then frees up the space we need over at the old facility to expand into that. One we talked about just in the last meeting or two for council was Safe Parking Project. We're going to come back again at the next meeting in December, in this December, and it's something we can do to help the individuals that are living in cars, RVs, whatever it is, on the streets. This program will then allow us to find a place, have them come in and park safe for the night, and typically 9 or 10 at night to 6 in the morning is when that parking area would be available. But there's a lot of rules and regulations that go with it. Santa Barbara went through and created an ordinance that said you can't park anywhere on the street with any single RV or any living, any car, anything you live in. That caused a lawsuit, so they had to go do something. So we don't want to go down the lawsuit stretch. We're going to propose again a pilot program. Council asked us to come back and fine-tune it, which is what we're working on right now. And we'll do it for 3 months, see how it works, see who shows up. And it's not just show up and you get to park. There's a whole list of rules. There's actually a manual that Santa Barbara has put together of what they recommend following. So you know, no drugs, no this, none of that. You have to work at moving out of your car or your vehicle into a real housing. So we're working on that one, but to do that and have security, have the person who does the interaction between the people and the nonprofits, we need that. Call center for utilities, we're looking at, we've put out two RFPs, or one RFP, but to the county and to Santa Maria to see if they'd be willing to give us a cost to take over the police and fire dispatch. Because it's very tough here in Longpoke to have the dispatch people to hire them and keep them. There's also that economies of scale where if you all go to one spot, they can dispatch to everybody. Not everyone should or needs to have their own. So we're looking at that. But in the meantime, part of the dispatch for utilities, my water, something happened, there's a water main blowing up. It's not police and it's not fire, it's utilities. Our current dispatch handles that. So we'll have an extra cost, but it's to the utility funds, not the general fund. But I wanted to make sure we added it in. We do have an outsourcing, it's a minor amount, it's $25,000. The alarm system here, we've had issues with it, I just recently found out, not just this building, but the library and other city buildings. We have to do something. The monitoring system that was put in place years ago isn't working, so we want to make sure the buildings are alarmed, but the signals aren't going properly to the police. We want to have that happen. So this is just another little over $1 million that we'll have to add to crack that nut. So. It's not easy. It's not something that people want to start with. I'd rather start with a surplus and say, hey, I get to spend money somewhere else. So this one's going to be tough. There's three options, really. You can reduce your expenses, you can increase your revenues, or you do a combination of the two. So again, it wasn't here to ask and have people solve the questions today. It's really for the council to ask questions of staff. Once they're done, we want to open up to everybody because this is the first step in being transparent. We want people to say, well, why aren't we not looking at cutting this or adding that? We want X amount of new public safety, or we don't need 200 acres of parks, or we don't need, it's a time for the community to come together when we have such a difficult situation and put forth their ideas. So the last one, and Dean, do you have So I got here, I've never had this happen. This was great. I mean, it's incredible that Dean has worked on it. This is just a working copy. He said, oh my God, it's not ready, don't show it, but I want to show it. He's going to dress it up, we're going to improve upon it. It's going to be an interactive worksheet, and we're going to list anything that we can think of that says, hey, and they're going to be the Chinese menu, so it's just going to have a whole list. You pick and choose. The idea is to start off with what is our deficit and what do we have to work towards? And it'll go through expenses. So it'll have, and these, I don't know if these are updated or not, but they're current. So we're gonna make different things. So if you want to add, give an example, just so you click on something. You see domestic violence support, Chamber of Commerce funding, different fundings there. We're gonna have different sections of this. So one, it'll be on the website. So you can do it from the comfort of your home in your pajamas on a Saturday morning, you don't have to come in here. And we'll think of everything we can. We'll ask council to give us ideas. And as you,
Yeah, I was just going to say, the things, the buttons I was clicking,
yeah,
that's not updated. The top is, but...
Yeah. So it'll look different, but the premise is the same. And I've been doing this 30 years, and when Dean and Brad showed it, I went, God, I wish I had this before. Because now citizens can really get involved. Before, it's just coming to a meeting, hearing what was presented, they get, you know, some input. This one, everybody will pick and choose and say at the very top, okay, there's the $3.9 million, or it'll be soon $5 million. How can we get that to say zero? It'll have initially cuts, we'll have revenue increases, ideas. It'll have other stuff that might add to that deficit, because someone might say, I want X amount more public safety. So it'll let you pick and choose. I want one, I want 10. If you said 10, that number gets bigger. It is going to be a really neat tool. And I think going forward, not just this year, but we're going to keep updating that, so every year the public can play around with it. I'd love to have had that before I got in this business to see it. So once we kick off the budget and Dean's able to get through the year-end financials, that's our CAFR, that's where we do the audit and everything comes up. It's a long process. So once we can let him take a breather for a minute, we'll work on this one. We'll start scheduling the budget hearings, and we're going to come back. My goal is to keep coming back, trying to do on a monthly basis at least an informational update to council to say, here's where we are, here's what's happening, and then have a few more of the budget hearings so where we can take ideas and say, hey, 80% of the people looked at wanting to do number 5 or 6, and we can present those types of ideas. Or you can all come up to the podium and say, here's mine, I balanced the budget, this is how I did it. We can look at all those different ideas. No one's probably be disagreement with everybody, but it's a really incredible tool to have to get that public input. So,
Jim, just to kind of follow up on some of the slides that were done, this presentation was being worked on up until about 7 o'clock last night. So we'll have it on the website next week. And part of the reason why we did it in such a brief fashion is to allow people to go through the slides on a more comprehensive basis. It's there for educational purposes. And it's there to elicit conversations about where things are at. One of the things that was kind of glanced over a little bit is there is a section on the individual divisions at the bottom left that shows budgeted and vacant positions. And that's important because it shows with a snapshot where we are at right now, I think with the last payroll of 11:30, how many vacancies we have. And if you recall, back in April, we had a similar presentation. At that point in time, we had about 20 vacancies throughout the general fund. And that, those vacancies are roughly the reason why we are able to try to get to the point where we have a chance to have a balanced budget for the 18-19 year. Those vacancies have fluctuated over time. They went down to about 14 at some point in time, but now they're up to about 27. So those 27 vacancies are in excess of 10% of the general fund's entire complement of full-time equivalent positions. So that's a big drop in productivity, for one, but it's a tool that we have available to us to try to get a balanced budget, considering the revenues from development basically are not as high as we had expected them to be. So this is a tool that you can bring home, look at, but those vacancy numbers are our primary tool to try to balance the budget, given the fact that other things are not variable. So that's just something to keep in mind, both for the council and for the audience here, the audience at home, and for people who are looking at the website later on. And this is the season for people to retire. So that 27 will probably grow, depending on if people leave between now and the end of the year. The total number of vacancies we have in the whole entire city is also over 10%. I think it's around 55 right now. So that's a pretty big number when we're trying to provide a level of services that are expected from the budget. So,
yeah, it's key to remember that part when you're playing with the model or coming up with ideas. Just, I forgot to mention that earlier, was that we have
10, 11 plus percent actually of the general fund employees are that they're currently vacant. And that was a big hit. You know, we try to do, and this is everywhere I've been, is you try to do anything you do from a staffing standpoint that will not impact the citizens. You know, and at some point it starts to impact the citizens. You just you can't help that. Yeah, 55 you said?
Can I make a comment? You know, on average we have about 5% year to year to year to year. It's about 5% vacancy across. The average city worker works 9.8 years on average. So it is a little bit high right now, but I think it's important also let everybody understand that we never are 100% filled, never. Because there's always people transitioning. It's always a moving and a flux. So I mean, yes, 10% is really high, but on average, we're sitting normally about 5%.
Right.
Also, keep in mind, there's 7 3/4 positions that were actually budgeted to be held too.
Yeah. So with that, I think that was our last slide. And we're like real close because we were trying to get this part to an hour. And then we wanted to give, you know, about 2 hours if it takes that long, depending on how many people have questions and how long the questions and comments from the council. So what I'd like to do now is open it up for the council to have comments, questions, and then when they are done, if you want to open it up to the...
Got a question.
Start with Councilmember Starbuck.
Yeah. Mr. Throop, something you might want to explain a little bit too is, you know, realizing that property tax makes up 50% plus, obviously then the way that we would want to increase revenue would be through development. We're now realizing that some development does cost us money, but on the other hand, could you give us a status on down the road a year or three, what the new development is or what's hindering us?
Yeah, in Lompoc, you want me to stand? I like standing, but so in Lompoc, we just came back, actually, we had a previous LAFCO meeting, and we had Councilmember Janelle at the time, and Councilmember Mosby and myself. Sorry?
What is LAFCO?
I was told don't use acronyms. I'm sorry. The Local Area Formation Commission. And what they do is that was started back in the 60s when people started doing land grabs. Cities started saying, well, I want to get that piece of property before someone else gets that piece of property. Or a developer came in and said, if I buy outside the city and build, then the city will annex me in and it'll be cheaper. And it was a way for the government to say, stop. You have to do a really logical way of annexing property. You go to Santa Barbara and you see Santa Barbara, and then they did the little tiny strip and then it went over to the airport. They didn't want that. You know, if you're gonna take the airport, you're supposed to have taken all of the property with it. And that happens every state. You know, people did that. So this formation of the Local Area Formation Commission was created, and over time, a lot of times, it builds upon itself, and it feeds upon itself, and it gives, you know, itself more powers, is how I'm personally seeing it. So what we're having to do is work with LAFCO and say, we need to expand our borders, because currently right now, what's trying to go through is that an edict is going down saying, you can't take one step over your current city limits. No, you can't do it. Well, that's not going to be a good thing for Lompoc. We do need to increase not just the housing stock, but also the ability for businesses to come in. I've had discussions with the base commander who says, God, it'd be great if you could have an engineering, you know, contingent down here, and then they design the rocket parts, and then you build the rocket parts, and then you drive it half a mile up the road. He said the last one they had to bring from Huntsville, Alabama, on a boat through the canal all the way up to the dockings at the old boathouse up there, they call it, but they couldn't unload it all at once. And then they had to back it out for the tide to come back in, and they bring it in, go back. He said, you know, if you could do something like that, it'd be wonderful. And I said, it would be, but we have currently within our realm of our city limits, there's really not any space to put in the Class A office buildings, to put in an industrial park that would design and build the different technology parts. So with that too, companies coming in, they're going to be paying these guys $200,000+ for their engineers, and they want a nice housing stock to choose from. I think, now where's Brian? Is it here today? We only had one house built this year, I think it was. And the story I was told was last year, year before, we had two that were taken down. So we're short one house in theory. So that's not a good process. So we need to get the ability to move out our borders on different sections, not just west, to the east, north, wherever we're going to go. That's a big piece. And I forgot, I'd rambled. What was the other question on that?
What's holding us back?
Okay, so outside forces at that point, because we have, I'll give you another example, and I do have 2 hours, so I can talk a lot, but we have Summit Homes, 44 homes, finally going in up at the Y. There's some issues, though, and they're not happy with how it went about. We annexed that property into the city. Again, it took a long time through LAFCO to do that. Right next to it is Burton Ranch. That's that part behind the Y. They're having frustrations because what's called a community services district, and what those are is they're a sort of a city, but it's not a city. They create these little special districts, and it's intended to help the county manage an area so they assess themselves for water, sewer, whatever they might have. It's like a little city, but it's not a city. They elect their own board, like we do the council, but they're overseen by the county. And in 1998, 2000, they annexed that whole Burton Ranch piece into the city. Somewhere along the line, LAFCO said, well, the utilities, water and sewer, electric, that all stays with the CSD, the Mission Hill CSD. So the big piece is there's 700 homes I would love to be built. They're going to have tiers. It'll be from 350, 650, and on up. And it gives a nice little choice of homes. But they're sitting there going, well, wait, we're in the city, but we have to get our water and sewer from the CSD. And I said, yeah, that's a problem. So we're trying to work with the CSD. There's a lot of issues that they have with their own infrastructure, and they do see Burton Ranch as being a possible savior because the amount of money that they want Burton Ranch to fix their systems is really, to me, above and beyond what is the impact of that development. So we've been having multiple meetings. We're trying to work on a deal that can take Burton Ranch and truly make it part of the city. It is a name, but it's not by the way services go. That would be another 700 homes on that one. LAFCO again to where we're facing to the west with the Bodger family, those properties out there on the Bailey Corridor, that's being held up. We're having to do multiple meetings there. One of the goals I'm trying to do and talk to council is we need to get someone on this commission. I went back and looked, in the last 20 years, only Mayor Deweese sat on it one time, and that was it. You know, Solvang, Goleta, Buellton, they've had multiple times, but the city of Lompoc's had one person in the last 20 plus years, and I couldn't go back further. And that's critical. We need a voice at that table, as everyone says. So we're going to be working. There'll be an alternate spot open, so our goal is to get someone on council in that spot and have a voice at the table. That'll be a big piece of it. There's other entities out there that are pushing LAFCO to hold back, and a lot of environmental groups. And we spoke, the mayor and I spoke at the last LAFCO, which is this week, wasn't it? Yes. And we were joined by Santa Maria, which was great. It was the first time it's been just Lompoc there. So Santa Maria came up and said, hey, look, you need to talk to the cities. You just can't make these arbitrary decisions on yourself. So the net of it is LAFCO is a piece that can make or break cities. They can let you expand. They can hold you steady and not move forward. And with Lompoc, one of our things we're missing is that growth potential to do anything that we can bring in our parts.
So to expand on that a little bit, just to give you some possible numbers, Jim mentioned Summit View. That's a 44-home subdivision that's going down towards the road of being developed. The annexation process with that, the 16%, a number that we put in the slides, that's citywide. Every little pocket is a little bit different. And with Summit View, the annexation agreement left us with 11% rather than the 16%. So based on 11% and not market value, but assessed value, say around 350, 400,000, maybe 500,000, you're looking somewhere around $20,000 a year that the city will be getting in property taxes from that 44-unit subdivision.
You know, thank you for bringing that up, Brad. Like I say, some development costs. Maybe you could give a little background. This is not so much budget, but is education so the public can know. How did we wind up in the situation where we're only getting 11 instead of 16%?
So the Local Agency Formation Commission is the entity that allows annexations, but we're annexing property that is in the county. So in that decision, we have to make a deal with the county. And the county has subdivisions that are in that area that are within the Mission Hills Community Services District, but they're also served by the county for various other activities. So the developer wanted to be developing in the city. He could develop in the county. So the county basically was looking at it from the point of view of, here's the services we can provide. We're closer for fire. We're closer for this. We think we can provide the services. We want to have our share of the property taxes that we have now. And without that done, what did happen is the developer said, I really want to be in the city. I'll make the city whole by providing within the community facility district the difference between 11 and the 16%. The drawback with that was great because it allowed us to move forward with annexation. The drawback is the money that is collected has to be used now in that area. So it's no longer general discretionary property taxes. It's CFD assessments that are available for that area. And CFD is
community
facility districts, which are tools we can use to provide services to new development that may not otherwise be available from general tax revenues.
Maybe you could also provide the idea of how long a timeline for these developments is, because I know a lot of people think it's exciting. These houses are built, we'll have property tax, it'll immediately rejuvenate our general fund, but unfortunately there is a longer window that we won't see these homes built for. So maybe you could explain that to the public.
So Summit View Homes, that's gonna be going, Brian, can you just a guesstimate on?
The Summit View Homes.
Nope, you gotta come up here. So Brian Halverson's our planning manager.
The Summit View Homes, they've submitted grading plans, and since the CFD was recently established, that would allow them to record the subdivision map. After that, we have in plan check the building elevations and floor plans, just your typical plans, and so we're expecting to see ground move in 2019. I would probably say early 2019, and the CFD was a key component, and the council just recently approved that, and so that's going to move forward next year, those 44 homes. That's probably, aside from that and the community health center, those are two big projects that are going to be under construction in 2019. The other ones that Jim's speaking about, especially annexation, that's going to take a lot of time. That's a few years away, I'm going to say that.
And so just to clarify, how long from start to groundbreaking has the Summit View taken? If you look back at when they first started working on annexation and just getting to this point, would you say it's been a year, 2 years, 3 years? I mean, it's been quite a while.
Yes, a number of years. It was annexed actually in 2016. And so, going through the CFD process and the various approvals, the development plans and things like that, it's a number of years. I would say it's going to probably, by start to finish, it's going to be over 5 years. So development does take a lot of time, but at the same time, it can really pay dividends to the city later as, you know, more taxes and other things that can bring to the city. Of course, the housing. There's a housing crunch in Lompoc, and people are constantly looking for new homes. And so to provide more homes in Lompoc is really key for us.
So, for instance, like on the Burton Hills, Burton Ranch, that was annexed in 2000. Now, granted, they may not have pushed hard in the beginning, but they really, with Brian, I've met with them at least a couple times. They really want to move forward, but again, there's this little roadblock in front of them that they're trying to get past. And even if that was passed and we got it all figured out, it's still going to be, we asked them, by the time they turn the first dirt to they sell the last house, it's 7, 8, 9 years.
That's
because of it's 700 homes, it's going to take a while for that one. If you look out to the west, then the property that's trying to be annexed in there, we're still trying to meet with LAFCO, trying to get past that roadblock to get approval to bring that in. Those individuals out there don't even have a plan. They know what they want to do. It's just not an approved plan. It hasn't been brought in the city. It's just the first step. So that one will take also, if we were successful with LAFCO this next year and they approved it, then it goes back and the owners of the property then have to begin the, you explain what the next steps would be after they get it annexed.
Yeah, I wanted to quickly go back. A lot of people, ask all the time, why aren't homes being built? Why is there a lack of construction in Lompoc? And some of that is related to projects that were approved years ago, even 05, 06, and they're just sitting, like the River Terrace project. There's another project off of East Street. So these sit on the market. They're either for sale or the developer is just waiting and waiting for the right conditions. And so that's another reason why, and of course, the prices that you get for a home in Lompoc is lower than most areas in the county. So I just want to emphasize that we do have projects that are sitting, and then Mosaic Walk is a smaller project, but they're just not getting built because the developers are waiting. And so that has been a bit of a frustration for the city because we really want to see those projects built, but the developers are not acting, and we have meeting after meeting when properties go for sale, and we're just waiting for those projects to be built. As far as the LAFCO process, it is going to take some time. We have an application in as of July of this year, so we're excited to move forward with that. We're meeting with the county planning department, so city planning and county planning are working together. They've made probably the biggest argument is the ag land. They don't want homes to be built on that ag land, so we are working through that. I do believe I'm optimistic that we can work through that challenge. But after that, if we can get through that challenge and actually go through hearings and move our sphere of influence, that line basically shows the overall growth of the city, where we want to grow. That would help to really expand the boundaries, and then later, if the city wants to look at other areas, we could do that. But 2019 is going to be very important for the city to look at expanding those boundaries, and that will include the Bailey Avenue corridor.
Any more questions on this topic? Councilmember Starbuck.
Yeah, one last thing I'd like to throw in here as far as education to the public on a budget challenge that's coming up here. On the PowerPoint that was out, page 21 showed the per property tax per capita, and then on page 23, the sales and use tax by per capita. I think that maybe an explanation of the demographics of Lompoc could probably enhance why Lompoc is on the far left of the scale on both of these. And I would use the example of, and these are rounded numbers, 30% is low income subsidized housing. So your property tax, we're not claiming property tax on a huge portion of properties that are in Lompoc. I will mention that owner-occupied homes in Lompoc are roughly around 45%. So they're turned over Section 8, et cetera. So the uphill climb based on the demographics of the city, if we could get something on that.
It is very tough. And we do have, I don't know if I stated publicly here in one of the council meetings, I know I've stated it in other places I've spoken, but the city right now has about 30% of their multifamily housing, which is essentially apartments, 30% of it is classified as low-income housing. Once it's classified as that, you lose the property tax. That's the incentive for these people to convert over to that. We just recently, we had one of our largest apartment complexes, correct me, Brad, if I'm wrong, convert over. So that was, apartments are a big property tax generator for the city, and they converted it over. We'd actually denied it. The property owner went to the state, and the state overruled us and said, yes, you may. And so you lose that home rule when the big person at the top says you must do it. There's others that have come through that wanted to build some more, but the thing I want to point out on the 30%, if you were to add up every other city in the county and what they have, it doesn't even equal 30%. So in the past, we were sort of the city to take that on. We need low-income housing somewhere, but honestly, from a balance, and I have to look at how you balance the budget. How do you, fair is fair. Other cities close by have 2%, 3%, down south, 5%, 6%, but the city here, we have 30% of our multifamily housing is in low income. So it is that's a piece for it. As property in general, we're not on the beach per se. We like to say we're a beach community maybe, but we're not Pismo Beach, we're not Santa Barbara, we're not someone that has huge, assessed values on it. So that is another issue there.
Councilmember Mosby.
Dean, on slide 47, I don't know if you could put that back up, but.
I got it. Okay. I have the control. That one?
Yeah. The red line being our expense, can you tell us what happened? What's the big step up here all of a sudden?
The main thing is the forecast model is we're going to go back to filling all positions. Like I said, we have 7 3/4 positions held. So our 18-19 is actually a balanced budget in this forecast model. We also have CalPERS enacting costs from the change of assumptions. So mainly the big bump though is us filling those positions that were held. You're talking $1.3 million in held positions.
Okay, well in 2017 we passed 4 resolutions. That's 6095, 6092, 6114. And I didn't write down that 4th one. But those amounted to nearly $2 million of increases in the general fund. We were told we could afford those expenses. How is it? I mean, I see now how we're affording it.
Yeah.
We're affording because we're holding positions vacant. But if we had that $2 million reduced every now, granted, what those were is raises.
Yeah.
The raises that were deserved, but we were told we could do this.
And to me, it's kind of like a double-edged sword. We saw what our revenue stream is per capita. We still have to provide public safety. We still have to pay fair wages, really. You want more people who are better committed? Do you want less people who are not as well committed and feel like they're being underpaid? It's a priority, but that's where you guys get to weigh in and tell us what you would like us to do going forward. You're absolutely correct, though.
I mean, but that's how we're affording. I think it's important for people to understand that this is how we're affording it, is we're holding positions open.
We are, and we are still quite a ways. When you see the slide, what our full-time looks like in the tri-counties, we are still quite a bit behind on our wages, and it's a tough thing to provide those services, but yet, balance the budget.
Right, and that's what I think a lot of that big bump is that takes us out of having a balanced budget when you assume that we're putting back.
Actually, the 18 and 19 is a base model assumption. It has all those raises in it. It's like I said, it's mainly those vacant positions not coming off and us going back to our service levels that we have in the budget book without the held vacancies.
Right, and I think it's important to understand that what we're going down, and if we are cutting some services, that what we're doing is we're going to have to pay for the raises that we passed out.
That's right. Yes, sir.
So, I mean, it's important when we move forward. And we had a lot of issues. We actually had some savings by giving the raises because it's very expensive to train the people to keep them here.
Mm-hmm.
So we really had some savings there, but it's...
We've seen a lot less vacancies through people leaving to better agencies that pay higher wages. I mean, that's a good thing, like you said. And also we get to keep that expertise of that training that we did for that person, too.
So, like I say, it's important to have that. I mean, I know it wasn't mentioned at all in the discussions that was something we could have controlled. It's nearly $2 million a year in general fund raises. But knowing we had to do what we had to do, and that's how we're paying for them now.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I'm learning on this game a little bit now. Next time I ask, how can we afford this, I'll make sure Yeah, I diagram exactly
like
down.
Like I said, when you say afford, you know, it becomes when do people become so unhappy and you can't keep them versus when you keep champions and have less champions.
No, I agree. I'm not opposed to what we did. I just want to make sure that this is what
we
understand.
It's a very good point, though, yeah.
And the other thing I want to comment on, you know, in the previous, in 17, looking at the audit or the financial report, the overestimations of both revenue and expenses were significant.
Yeah.
You know, $2.4 million overestimation of revenue and a $6 million overestimation in expense. I mean, that gets you in a bad position where you can get, you know, credit cards running out of control.
It does, because when you pass appropriations, that's your limit. You can't spend more than what you pass in appropriations. We kind of knew that, but we also have a lot of road fund revenues and expenses baked into there just in case we have a project that we can work on and if we can get funding for it. So you're right. I think we did pretty good. If you look at the slide, were we about $1 million off on?
Yeah, so he's going to come at $900,000. That's a significant reduction in
and
our
me and Brad have worked very hard to try and go through our budget and make sure it's reflecting what we think is really going to happen. There's been a lot of stuff that's been past practice that we were, why is that there? You know, why is that there? Well, let's change it to this. Let's change it to this so it does reflect closer what our actuals are going to look like.
And it's important to have a budget that's much tighter than that. That's not so. And
especially when you're talking about the required supplemental information, the budget to actuals. And we're also doing a lot of things, you know, to change that. So when we come to you guys, it's good information and you can make decisions. And that's really what that whole slide section was on all those percentages out and costing us. More information we give to you guys, the better decision you guys can make about where we need to go.
Well, let me qualify that. The more accurate information.
Yeah.
That
yeah.
Estimated expenses being $6 million off was a mess. That got us in a degree of mess. And we did have some interesting revenue that came in. I guess you brought money from an insurance fund or our previous time we would be sitting at about $3 million deficit.
Yeah, if you remember, you go back, I took a lot of one-time anomalies out of there. That was one. There was also a very important one that makes that page more accurate is to when you do accrual for how many days there is in the year for salaries, we went from just doing the 27th payroll and putting the insurance fund to actually accruing the actual days that are in the year. That was an important accounting change, and that went the other way around. So yeah, we want to, like I said, we want to make sure that information is going to be that our original budget is going to be very close to our actual budgets. If not, why are we missing it?
We would have been off about $3 million off, right? If you hadn't
3.2 or 3.1 was my estimate, yeah.
And then you were able to bring about 2 million something.
And I also keep in mind that 27th payroll, what way it worked, I think, is it kind of misled the numbers, and that's why we decided to fix that, and that's important, I think, going forward, that we do that counting practice correctly.
Thank you.
Councilmember Vega.
May I? One other thing that's causing that bump between 19 and 20 is the CalPERS pension obligations that we have. They have been ramping up our contributions over a five-year span to help mitigate the costs to us, but it caused our contributions to grow substantially over the last 5 years. That ends after 2020. So in the 19-21 budget cycle, citywide, not just in the general fund, but citywide, we'll see a 37% increase in contributions to CalPERS just for our unfunded liabilities because of that ramp up. And since that ramp up, they also did another change in their assumptions that will basically continue our increases through 2030. So it's a significant challenge that we're going to be seeing budget cycle after budget cycle after budget cycle. One thing Jim mentioned earlier is that city government is, government in general, is kind of unique compared to businesses or your home finances. One of those things that I thought was interesting when I first came into government is that you have to plan for the long term, but you budget on a one-year basis, or in our case, a two-year basis. So you need to get a budget balanced for those 2 years, but you also have to know you have to plan for those things that are 20 or 30 years out. That's a really difficult balancing act for any board, whether it's our city council or any other agency that's required to have a balanced budget. So having a balanced budget is one thing. Having a balanced structural operations going forward is a whole different different thing, because what you see up here is basically a structural deficit that we have going based on our current status quo activities, our service levels we have right now. We don't ever see that red line that's up there going below where the blue revenues are coming in.
And may I jump in? I don't know if you recall, Brad, the what our initial, I know we talked once, what we were paying in CalPERS back in 2004 and what
well,
we're paying.
Well, the slide that has the bell curve on it for the two city plans and the county plan, that goes back all the way to, I think, 2000. And around 1999, 2000, the citywide contributions was around $1 million. And by 2025, it's going to be $14 million, roughly.
So I like to, you know, put out that this isn't, it's not something the city did. It's not the council had an oops or the finance department. What happened really, and this is almost all cities, I do get jealous. There are some cities out there that have paid off their liabilities. And some of those are, you know, the higher income Beverly Hills. There's some out in the desert that have a lot of tourism come in and they've paid off their unfunded liability, or they're newer cities. You know, we're a very old city, so ours goes back quite a ways. Some that have only been in existence 10 or 15 years, they can do that. It happened when Gray Davis was in charge. I'll pull his name out and I'll throw it out there. But during that time, it was sort of that snowball effect. He approved the increase in benefits for a certain area of labor, and it increased it quite a bit. So if you were to retire tomorrow, this is how it worked, but he implemented it today, signed the bill, and it took effect today, let's say, making it easy. I would have gotten that increase, even though I paid nothing into it, no cities paid anything into it. So this unfunded liability began right then and there. Instead of phasing it in, saying, okay, going forward in the next 10 years, then they'll start getting this new increase. But it was signed one day, and essentially the very next day, you could retire at 30 years, and you now have this much bigger retirement. So that's what caused it, because a lot of cities, ones that I were in, we'd been what they called superfunded. We were above, and we had more than we needed. As soon as that went into effect, you're down below the line, you went, uh-oh, now we're in trouble. So it wasn't anything that cities self-imposed upon themselves. It's really what was done at the governor's level, and now we all have to make up for it. So.
Before I move on to Councilmember Vega, could you also explain how other divisions of labor decided they needed the same, so it kept increasing? And then secondly, how CalPERS itself is self-managed and chose to fund themselves in a way that is not as aggressive?
Right. So the first piece that went in when I was mentioning the different, trying not to get too into it, was the correctional officers were given this increase, and then it trickled down to such as the Highway Patrol, and then once they got it, other state agencies, and then it trickled down to the cities. And things were going well when this was going on. So agencies said, yeah, we'll pay for that. Cities would say, you know what, we'll pay for the employer side and we'll do the employee side, because it wasn't that big of a deal at the time. And again, like Brad said, they weren't looking out far enough. Other issues that came into play was CalPERS they have a board, they manage themselves, they're a big entity. I mean, 2,500, 3,000, I forgot how many employees they have. And so they decide on what the rate of return is, because we pay them the money, they go out, they invest it. Those two together are supposed to create those annuities that then they can pay everybody off in retirement. They had some really pie in the sky dream, and I'm sorry? 7.5 was a return on average year over year they would get, some up, some down. But what they did also is they had a corridor, because sometimes they were below 7.5. And so when they were below, they would say, hey, you cities, you have to pay us this much money. We'll give you 15 years to pay it off. And that's for 1 year. Next year, they might also be below 7.5. They say, okay, you're short this much again. You have another 15 years. So this liability just kept growing and growing and growing. The historic recession hit. People went, whoa, wait a minute. This is you know, it's a pyramid scheme, if you will, because it's unsustainable the way it is right now. You just can't keep collecting debt. So that was one thing. But the other one that's it bothered me is, and I do want to save the environment, and I want to do all that stuff, but when it comes to the point when you're investing other people's money, they would do a lot of investing in what I'll call the green industry. And it had a much lower return on investment than others. And so I don't know if you and I talked about it, whether they're changing that or not, but they need to change it if they haven't already and say, you know what, we'll come back to that investment. But right now, we need to take everything and put it in what is the best legal, most advantageous for the fund, build that up. Then when you get to we don't have to be 100%. That's sort of what everyone says you have to be. You don't really have to get up to that level, but let's shoot for it. Once you get up to that level, though, then go back and start investing in something else, but not right now. So and we don't have say in that. It's the board, the CalPERS board that has say in it. We can write letters and whatnot, but unfortunately, it doesn't always do much.
So again, just to make sure the public is aware that it's a bill we have to pay no matter what, and we have no control over what that bill's gonna look like on a regular basis, because it changes based both on board decisions by CalPERS and the current market and how they've chosen to invest and that impact that gets passed on to us. Councilmember Vega, you have patiently waited. Please take the microphone.
Thank you. This slideshow that we have here, this PowerPoint on paper, is actually pretty clear to see where we're lacking and what's being subsidized here. I'd like to ask City Manager or Dean or whatever, we have commissions and committees that haven't been included here, but I'd like to see whether, you know, efficiency-wise, it's nice to know whether it's negligible on the budget or if it has an impact or it has no impact. Because it doesn't look like there's a separation here in the budget books. It'd be nice to know if it's already figured in, for one thing.
So what is a cost to run whatever commission? No, I don't know, Dean, if you've ever figured it out.
Or as a whole, you know.
Right, and I wouldn't look at just a commission. I'd say in commissions in whole, we haven't costed that out. There's the cost of staff that are hourly, that have to bring forth all the information, because typically with a commission, the department head and maybe another person who's exempt, and exempt employees are the ones that don't get the overtime, they'll usually be at the different commission meetings. So they don't have any cost per se there, but they do have an opportunity cost where they're at the meetings versus doing some other kind of work. But that would be, you know, an arbitrary number, subjective number you could come up with. But we don't have anything from a true labor cost to do that. It's something we can try to do. We'd have to get with every commission, you know, the department head that runs that, and ask them, how many people do you usually use? How much time does it take to prep for it? And then who goes to the actual meetings? And then on the follow-up, how much is that? So.
Yeah, thank you. I'm just looking for if it's any significant impact or not, in a positive or negative way. You know, it may be negligible because it's already figured in. And it's being paid by a different part of the
right
fund.
Brad, were you going to say something?
Well, the bottom line is that each individual division that has the responsibility to be the staff support for a particular division, they're already assigning some portion of their workload to that. So that's built into the budgets. What Jim was mentioning is that it's an opportunity cost. Do you want to spend X number of hours on managing an agenda, or do you want to spend next amount of hours on a program for that division? And right now, they're providing the support services necessary to run the commissions.
Gotcha. And I was always looking to see if maybe in the future we can bring up the fact that if each individual commission, or since it's each department, has its own budget, which varies, mm-hmm. To run each commission or to allow the commission to spend any money. It'd be kind of nice for transparency. I come from a different mindset here with my business background and being a real estate broker. I think your input is so important here. I think part of the budget process, as I've spoken to the city manager, is without a plan for our future, what we want Lompoc to be, and I'll bring this up, we're playing with numbers without knowing how to sustain and substantiate any of these numbers. I look at public safety as something that's going to move Lompoc forward, not backwards. I look at it as a cost, but I also need to look at them as individual groups. Police and fire, they have their own responsibilities, and sometimes we bundle everything up as public safety. I don't think it gives credence to what you guys actually do, so I think it's so important for us to look at that moving forward. I look at some of the opportunities that businesses have also, so I think along with this, as part of the budget process, we should probably all use all our resources, because I see that you guys are all interested, and the city's probably, and the town's probably watching on TV. That we need to be a part of the plan moving forward. Whatever budget we have that's in a negative stature, how are we going to rebuild it? Can't always be with raising and increasing fees for the people that have limited income and disposable income without the plan. I think customer service is key, and I think in our building and planning, I think we're all on the same page here, but I think we have to incentivize and let our employees know exactly what's needed so that we can move a project forward in a more expedient manner, so that we can look at the long-term gain instead of the short-term gain at the counter. Sometimes we're a little bit short-sighted, and I think some of the businesses that come in here, sometimes that leave as a statistic, we're too late. We're too late there. We should be supporting these businesses from City Hall all the way down, even if it's a compliance issue. I look back at our years back, we were... Our percentages for low-income housing, as Councilman Starbuck mentioned, is too high based on the county. It's not fair that the percentages are 5% and 6% for Santa Maria and Guadalupe and all these other cities, where Lompoc has 29-30%, and then we have a home ownership at 45% or possibly less here. So even the opportunities that come in, so I would just kind of like to mention here that when we have new businesses come here, maybe we can ask these businesses what their wants and needs are, and if they're bringing in living wage jobs, and which could require housing, there's a lot of things here the city just questioning. It's not that they can control everything, but it also gives us information. I look back at our housing. You know, again, housing's not going to be the save the city type of entity. It provides services, but it provides people options to live, because they need that. They need to see and have choices, because we're losing out to Santa Maria. We can't compete with Santa Maria, but we lose the, even being a choice. We can go and dance with Vandenberg Air Force Base all we want, but if we don't have the choices to provide the support groups, then they're only going to stop and fly by and come and eat here, but they're never going to live here because there's not enough choices. Because if you go to Santa Maria and you go see all these new home subdivisions, you just can't compare, okay, if you're willing to commute. I think that we need to keep our people from bleeding out as far as they have choices on commuting versus wage differentials, but at the same token, the city has a lot to offer here as far as cost of living. So I think that, again, going back to the budget, I think that probably with a plan moving forward, even if we're in a negative on our budget, how do we shore it up, okay, without a good plan? It sounds like we're doing status quo and we're doing the same old thing all the time. The permitting process needs to be shored up. We have a computerized system now for finance, which is great, and yep, it's probably a lot better now. Before, they had 3x5 cards. You couldn't go back and look back. They had Windows, 86 or 89, something like that, or whatever you call it, XP, right? Wasn't there something like that?
Yeah, it was a very old system. It was originally a Unix system developed that we got, and I think we had it since 1986. And it's a ton of work to implement the new system, but it's going to take us quite a while before we can take advantage of all the bells and whistles it has.
Gotcha. In closing here, it sounds like I'm just going forward, but I think of the plan here as part of the budget process for whatever the numbers come out with, I think we can shore up, and it may prevent us from having to do something nobody wants to do, okay? Because if we can go and shore up our own boat, then we're going to be better off. But status quo is not going to work, because we're always going to be in a deficit with wondering if Lompoc's ever going to be built out, who's going to come in here, when we can't support the people that are here sometimes because we wait till they fail, and then it's too late because we haven't asked enough questions. That was my spiel. Thank you.
Councilmember Mosby.
Hey, can you go to slide 11? I don't know if I thanked you guys for putting this together. I know you did a lot of work crunching a lot of numbers and such on there. I mean, there's a lot to digest and go through, but the big bump, 16 to 17 on expenses, what were we doing? And where did money come from and where'd the money go? I mean, that's vertical climbs.
That's one of the things I was talking about, how we changed the way we did our accounting practices for that extra payroll. I mean, I think a lot of it was the extra payroll and not accruing it correctly. And that's one of the things that we did a one-time anomaly and changed and fixed.
And that's where you're able to where did the money come from?
Well, in that particular case, it wasn't money. We mentioned, what Dean mentioned was that we pay every 2 weeks. So every 2 weeks is 52 weeks a year, so you would think that would be equal to our year's worth of cost. But in actuality, it's 364 days, and we have sometimes 365 days. Once in a while, we have 366 days. So that creates a abnormal situation in the fact that we actually had 27 payroll periods where we paid in 2017. So that was cash that actually went out the door, but my predecessors had always taken that into consideration, and every single budget cycle we accrued basically 1/14th of that amount, so that by the time we had a year where there's 27 payrolls, we were able to take care of it. The other issue, so when we had Glenn Burdett come in to do our audits, they typically look at matching expenses and revenues. So our expenses, we would always keep track of our costs on a biweekly basis. So we would always have 52 weeks of costs, plus the extra that we were set aside for the 27th, which happens every 11 years. So when they said, where's the accumulated expense for the period from whatever the last payroll period date was until June 30th? I said, we don't do that because we capture 365 days of cost every year. What we didn't do is we didn't capture that last bit and match up expenses with the year. So we, in 2017, our last payroll cycle ended on June 23rd. So we had 7 days where that was actually paid on July 7th. So that, since that was a 27 payroll period and it was exactly 7 days, I decided that we should take the recommendation from Glenn Burdett and accrue our costs through June 30th. So that extra week was an expense on the books, but we didn't pay that until July 5th. So it wasn't any extra money we paid, we just accrued it and expensed it into the 16-17 year and reversed it off in the 17-18 year. And then in 17-18, we accrued 8 days instead of 7 days because that's how many days you had in that year. So now we are matching our expenses with our revenues, and we, from 17 on, we will still have 365 days of cost for payroll every single year. This was just a one-time true-up to get us from the way we used to do 364 days to be 365 days and matching our payroll to our financial period.
And another thing is that wasn't the total thing that happened either. I mean, it was a big part. I think the main thing is we were putting the budget together, and can you go to the last slide? We realized that we couldn't keep going the way we were going. I'll get to that last slide, and then I'll tell you. I had to pick the last one, didn't I? If you look at this last slide, when it comes up here, when we started putting the budget together for 17-19, this is what we saw. Yeah, this is what we saw. we were, what are we going to do? One of the things we did is we said that we were going to hold the 7 3/4 positions, about $1.4 million, and the rest we've been absorbing through vacancies. So yeah, we're seeing it down, but our revenue stream wasn't there to sustain it. So that was some tough decisions this last 2 years. We've been holding a lot more vacancies than the normal, like you said, about 5. But we have another 7 3/4. We're up to 13. We're actually at 27. We're holding 10 additional positions. That's like a million something on order if it's trying to bridge this gap. We were lucky enough that we had the Hilton Garden to help us on the revenue stream side. So, and we've had some really good sales tax and property tax increases. We've been very lucky with the numbers we've been given, but a lot of this was, it was an we need to slow down.
Can you comment a little bit more on those revenues, because I think they came in a little higher than anticipated, and both, well, not the TOT wasn't necessarily, but the sales tax revenues, right?
Yeah, we've actually seen very good sales tax revenue increases year over year. I mean, it's been a saving grace for us, really. And TOT
anticipated
too.
Anticipated about 650,000, got a million or something, what was it?
Incrementally year over year?
Yeah.
Yeah, and unfortunately, the increases for the unfunded accrued liabilities for the pensions is almost the same amount. So if we were going to give anybody a raise, we have to figure out some sort of way of cutting somewhere else in order to fit it into the budget.
It's important to put that out there too. It's not all doom and gloom. I mean, there's a lot of good things going on, and increased revenue like that is significant.
And like I said, we know housing, it takes a long time for us to see those revenue streams, especially in property tax.
And that goes back to what I was saying earlier about we're statutorily required to have a balanced budget, but on an annual basis. And that's why we produce a budget every 2 years to meet that requirement. But in our last two budget cycles, we've actually shown the next few years out. It'd be great if somebody passed a law that says you have to be balanced for 10 years, and then the mindset of trying to balance 1 year would change. So we, again, it's a balancing act. We have to look at short term and long term to try to figure out how we can balance the short term for the statutory requirements. How can we balance long term to meet our service level requirements that you guys have? Because the service levels dictate how much we have to put in the budget for the current year. It doesn't necessarily have to say, here's what we're going to do in year 5, 6, 7, 8. That's just down the road. We have to deal with those in 5 years, 6 years, and 7 years. So
I think that's where trend lines and graphs using 3 months before and after and graphing on trends can show you your direction you're going and anticipating as well.
Right. And one thing that Dean mentioned earlier is that we see some clouds in the horizon. We've heard people say maybe 2019 could be a recession. Maybe 2020 could be a recession, 21, somewhere out there. The only certainty is that there will be a recession at some point in time. Whether it happens in the next 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, we don't know. Typically, recessions aren't necessarily caused by just people stopping buying. It's caused by some sort of shock to the system. So that could happen anytime. And one of the things that I've been seeing at the state level is Governor Brown has been putting aside money into reserves, and some discussion is why don't we spend that? So right now they have roughly $18 billion in their specified reserves. The economists out there, I went to a session at UCLA earlier this year, and any recession typically cuts revenues for any government entities for a two-year period. So over a two-year period statewide, a recession is gonna probably reduce revenues by $35 billion. So that $18 billion that the state has is only good for 1 year. It's not good for the whole entirety of the recession. And we also would like to have something like that, which is why we have a reserve policy that states we should have this money set aside just in case. And that's over and above trying to see how we can manage our costs, manage our revenues, so we can have a balanced budget and can provide the services that are necessary, that are wanted by the community and desired by the governing board, you guys. So
Just quick, Councilmember Starbuck, is this on the same topic? And if not, can I ask a question?
It's related. It's
okay,
budget.
Go ahead. Yeah. No, I meant on the tax discussion and the income and change.
It is part of it. One of the things I've noticed, your net expenditures consistently shows an internal service fund and other enterprise. Are these related to cost allocation and enterprise reimbursement?
No, they're just basically the other funds, the other enterprise funds. Examples of those are transit. The internal service funds, examples of those are fleet division and our stores division that provides purchasing and inventory services. So there are other divisions that are getting services to them or providing services the same way that everybody else has.
Okay, so the general fund tax revenue history here reflects none of these out of allocation or reimbursement then?
Right, those are just purely tax revenues. That's just showing what's coming into the general fund from taxes that are available for discretionary expenditures.
Well, the internal transfers that are happening then are not reflected in general fund here anywhere.
Not in that slide that you're looking at. Well, no.
None of the slides.
That's correct. When I do the net costing, that's what I'm taking out. I'm taking out all the allocations. I'm also taking out charge for services. So if an inspector goes out and does an inspection and that revenue comes in, I take that out of their, I actually take their gross, subtract that out to get the net. So we can see what things are costing the general fund. How much does it really cost to run these divisions after it's all said and done?
I think it's important also to share with the community why the difference between our projected budget versus what's happening actual and the different rates that the different types of taxes come in and why it makes it so difficult to deliver a budget on an actual budget on a regular basis because of those timelines, whether they get reported quarterly, annually, and when we get them delivered. I think that would help the public. No? Not going to share with
when
the sales tax come in? When does our property tax come in?
Well, there are some oddities with property taxes. Everybody has to pay property taxes that owns a home or some other property. Those payments are required to be paid by December 10th and April 10th. So because of those payment timelines, the cities typically only get two major distributions a year. They get one sometime in late December, and then probably May, sometime that time frame. So for a city that doesn't have the luxury of having cash flow that is provided through utilities, we keep everything separate, but that when the cash comes in, we're able to track cash on a pool basis, so we don't have some of the issues that other cities have that only have general government, because some of those agencies have to live between June and December without any kind of substantial revenues from property taxes. For sales tax, somebody went out and got Starbucks today. The money that is generated from that 7%, 7.75% sales tax, the city only gets 1% of that for one thing, and it doesn't come to us until 4 to 6 months after that transaction occurs. So there's always a 3-month lag between the time that somebody gets the money and the time that we get it. So we get a monthly distribution from what used to be the State Board of Equalization, but then on a quarterly basis they true that up. And that's all on cash basis, so for those periods where that includes the Christmas shopping season, we'll see higher revenues, and for the areas outside of that, we'll see lower revenues. But on an annual basis, we'll see the ups and downs that we track pretty closely. The other vagaries, getting back to property tax that I was going to talk about, which is kind of odd, is that we build a house. If we build a house today, it's not going to be on a tax roll until January 1st, and that being on a tax roll January 1st. We won't get that money until the following December. So that doesn't mean the taxes aren't paid by the individual who's bought that house. The money that comes in before the secured property tax that we get, that's actually pooled throughout the agency, throughout the county. And because of laws that were passed decades ago to help make it easier for assessors to divide tax monies up, we only get our proportional share of the supplemental taxes during the year where the first year happened. And a really good example of that is what happened last year in the South County. The devastation occurred because of the fires and because of the floods actually reduced property values on the South Coast by almost $2 billion. So those people who lost their homes through those tragedies got relief on property taxes. Well, that's through a mechanism that's actually not affecting those individual jurisdictions that are would be the normal recipient of that money. It's pooled. So part of the reduction that occurred because of those issues down south actually reduced our property taxes for the current year by a small amount. And it reduced the property taxes throughout all the agencies, whether they were directly affected or not. And that combination was done basically because people didn't have enough computing power to figure it out. Well, that doesn't exist today. So that law, which is still in place, provides for that melding of ratios to make it easier for the allocations, which means we received less money by roughly $8,000 of property taxes than we otherwise would. The nice thing is that the state legislature realized that and they passed a law that will backfill all those agencies that had those tax reductions and make everybody whole. When that happens, I don't know, but we'll get our $8,000 back and the South County will get the money that they would have received had those reductions not occurred. And that's one of the things that Jim mentioned earlier about the vagaries of government. There are things that are done decades and decades ago that make things easier to manage, but it also kind of peanut butters everything, so you only get maybe a little bit of what you would otherwise get. So, and I'm saying that because if we had, for some magical reason, we had all of Burton Ranch develop all at once, we got all 700 homes, if that was done on January 15th, we'd only get a share of that. The rest of it would be shared with the rest of the entities in the county. So we would get the, once that first year is over, we definitely get all of our 16% of the 1%. But in that first year, it's shared across borders.
Thanks for that clarification. I think that's really important to understand because we all deal with our personal home budgets and we have monthly bills and we get our paychecks monthly and different things come in regularly. So you see it come in and you see it go out. Whereas with a government budget, every month we have expenses and we have to pay those, but not all our revenue comes in at the same time. So it's often a balancing act between, and again, I know a lot of us are asking, well, why do we have utilities and why do we have our own utilities? And sometimes it's the saving grace for us because we have the ability to float between when that revenue comes in and be able to still make those bills. But I think it helps explain to the public why government budgets and government payments and how we run a business isn't a business because of all the parameters and limitations that we have in having those making those decisions. Back to Councilmember Vega's comment about streamlining the permitting process. As a member of, as Lompoc's representative on Home for Good, the quarterly meeting happened this week, and one of the presenters came forward about a Senate bill that has moved forward and will go into effect in January, where the state is mandating the streamline of permitting process. And they're proposing, one of the consultants proposed, that maybe all of the cities and the county pull that potential $1.5 million and have a single permitting process developed that all of the cities and county could utilize so that we all streamlined and got a better program from that. So that will be coming back towards us to potentially participate. And I like the idea simply because we're often told, oh, you're so much harder to work with than so-and-so city, and you're so much more difficult than the county. But if we potentially took advantage of, instead of taking a portion of that 1.5 and paid our own consultant to do something, and another city took a 1.5, if we pulled that and we were all having the same process, then we couldn't be pointed at to say, but there is those potentials out there to become better at doing these things we're required to do. And I support the idea that we need to evaluate not externally but also internally. What is our efficiency? Are we doing the job as best we can? Are we missing the tools? Instead of necessarily investing in more people, is there a tool we need to invest in so they can do their job more efficiently? And then, of course, redoing and evaluating the reimbursement fee study to make sure that it's not just someone track their time, and this is what the reimbursement is, and this is how we're collecting it, but are we efficiently doing that work first? And that's what the result of that time frame is, and then how is that reimbursement funding mechanism being implemented inside the city? So those are absolutely things we can do in the future and need to be part of a long-term plan, not just a short-term plan. Any other questions for staff by council before we open it up to the public?
I have one suggestion, just a 10-minute break.
Oh, that would be awesome. How about a 10-minute break, and then we'll come back and open it up to public comment. All you people drinking way too much coffee.
We'll be right back.
to questions and comments from the public. And while we aren't going to put the timer clock up, please consider staying within a 2 to 5 minute window just to be respectful to having a chance for either staff to reply and give answers or council to follow up with any of those questions. But we'll try and make the best use of the next 45 minutes. Go ahead.
Good morning. My name is Leah Shada. I have been a Lompoc resident since 1997. I want to thank you first for having this workshop. I find that it's very proactive, and as a retired government finance person, this budget talk is really exciting to me.
Uh-oh.
My goal is to help you increase resources, and forgive me my ignorance, I might be a little bit rusty because I retired many years ago. I have a lot of questions, a lot of ideas. I'll try to keep it to 3 minutes here. And of course, I would need to read your line item budget to give you specific information. I want to thank you for the economic indicators that you talked about. I would like to see additional information about local vacancy rates. I like the idea of streamlining the permit process, and I'd like to take that a step further. I'd like to talk about the concept of business incubators, or something smaller than a business incubator, where we tap our local retired resources to mentor local businesses and foster not only the growth, but their success locally. I have three quick questions, Madam Mayor. Does the city have a risk manager, grant coordinator, and legislative advocate?
We do have a contract for doing grant management, so we don't actually have in-house. We do have some staff who pay attention to potential grants related to their different departments. Risk manager, I believe so.
Is HR.
Is the HR department. And no, we do not have our own lobbyist for either the state or the federal.
Thank you. My concern with grants is that you have to be careful about accepting grants because they often come with long-term obligations. And speaking of long-term, I understand that the city adopts a 2-year budget. We're working with a 4-year council. And I appreciate Brad's comments about long-term planning because the city is an entity that is how old?
130 years old.
And we should be planning well beyond 2 years. And again, he made a good point that you will change your perspective if you're planning for the long term versus the short term. I think that a salary savings percentage of 11% is way too high. It's not an efficient way to run an operation. It's a false savings. What you save in salary savings, you spend in overtime. And if that rate continues, then you need to look at those positions to see if they truly need to exist. So there's an area that I would look at personally. So I'd encourage you to either fill those positions to increase your efficiency or delete them. I like the comments that Jim made about direct versus contract services, especially in regards to public safety. As the retired finance director of the local Santa Barbara County Sheriff Department, I was on the other side of that negotiations process, and there's a great savings when you share anything that is a 24/7 service, especially for the smaller entity. I would have liked to have seen a map of the sphere of influence. I like the talk about the LAFCO information, and I will just close by saying that I'm available to volunteer on one of these issues. I'm not looking to run for office. I'm not looking for a job, but I'm happy to help volunteer. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. I really appreciate when individuals step up and are willing to not only have a discussion, but potentially contribute to the solution. So thank you, Leah.
Thank you again for having this budget forum this morning. I appreciate it. City marketing to bring in people, great idea, and I think we should do more of that. Make this city really cute. Landscaping, do things to make it more attractive. There have been improvements since we've had the change, but we can really expand on that. I think we should request the county reimburse Tom Polk for the riverbed cleanup. That was very expensive, county property. Stand up to him. Lompoc for Lompoc. The county relaxed rules for Montecito to rebuild, so it can be done. We haven't, fortunately, had that catastrophe here, but if you can do it, do it. The county can relax, we can relax. I sat through a council meeting and they talked about 2 years for the cannabis planning process or something. Some people are going to build a rocket in 4 years and take people to the moon that want to go. Excuse me, Mars. So things can be speeded up. I think we should look at things in a new way, not just how it's always been done. Central planning is not a good thing. We should make Lompoc rules for Lompoc. It's the first time I've heard of the Local Area Formation Commission. It's a good thing to know about. We should be the ones that make those determinations about our borders. Others tell us how much Section 8 housing we should have. It's like we don't really have control of Lompoc. That needs to change. The state has educated us about how sanctuary cities work. Perhaps we need to be a sanctuary city from Sacramento or Santa Barbara County and make some of our own rules that will benefit us. I'm very serious. When I moved here from Nebraska, this is so perfect. I couldn't figure out who's got the boot on the neck of Lompoc. What's holding this little city back? Well, turns out maybe it's elected officials. Let's see. Projects waiting to be developed. If a developer comes in and they have the land secured or on hold or whatever, and they don't do anything with it, they should pay a fortune every year to hold that project until it's built. If they don't build it, whatever deposit they put forth, and it should be huge, they lose their deposit. There's either a lot of money to be made there with those projects that aren't going forward, or they're canceled. Let somebody else have the option. There are people that live in Lompoc that have work in Lompoc, very good jobs, live north of Santa Maria. They have the money to be living in Lompoc if there were housing. The CalPERS, and we have no choice. We do have choices. We're Americans, we're citizens, we're independent, we're not sheep. We have choices. Perhaps this is something else that we should self-fund. I think it's very important that we pay people appropriately and they have retirement. But the governor makes decisions on how much we're going to spend, yet we're statutorily required to have a balanced budget. That doesn't pencil out very well. They imagined or expected a 7.5% return. That was what was projected. We didn't get it. It's my understanding the difference between what was projected and what we actually got compounds as in negative amortization. So it's a huge effect overall. I think that compounds. Can we self-fund our retirement? Can we be a sanctuary city from CalPERS? We do have control. I don't think we should have the attitude that we have no control over these things. We do. We're a separate city. Thank you.
Before we go on to the next comment, would either Dean or Brad explain what it would take to self-fund? There are ways to exit out of CalPERS and continue to fulfill our commitment, but that is a very large and drastic step.
So CalPERS allows agencies to get out of membership, but it also provides for the payment of already earned benefits to all the people that are in that program up until you exit, which what they call a termination payment. That termination payment is based on basically the present value of the available assets that can be earned at a guaranteed rate, which is probably around 3%, 4%, 5%, rather than the 7% that they earn on their regular portfolio. So for us, I don't have the numbers in front of me, but the numbers for exiting either the miscellaneous plan or the safety plan are in the hundreds of millions of dollars. So that we would be able to do that, but we'd have to pay them up front, one lump sum to get out. And then we would have the ability to do anything we want with future payments for future members going forward.
Okay, thank you.
Speaking of that, a question on the stock and a question on the flow. On the stock, what is the quantum, what is the quantity of the projected benefits obligation for the city of Lompoc? And conversely, the market value of its assets, meaning how deep underwater is the city?
Based on the valuations for 2017, June 30th, 2017, which is the most recent valuations that have been completed, both of our plans are just right around 70 to 71% funded, which means we have assets to meet our obligations 70 cents on the dollar.
Yes. On what quantity are we speaking of? 29% of 10 million, 100 million? What is the quantity?
So our total accrued liability at June 30th, 2017, for all the members that are either active retirees or in the system but not actively working for us, but maybe working for somebody else, is about $280 million.
Okay.
So we have about 70% to cover that $280 million.
So we're speaking almost 30% of $280 million. $84 million, more or less?
Roughly, yes. Mm-hmm.
To be amortized in how many years?
We currently are on their default program, which is the 30-year amortization schedule. One thing Jim mentioned earlier is that CalPERS has continued to change their policies to strengthen their ability to get us from the 70% to an 80% level.
Yes, I've seen that.
So as an example, in the downturn in 2008, the policies that they had was effectively 15 years to amortize those losses, but every single year it would re-amortize the amount that was due over 30 years. So it was a rolling 30-year amortization process.
Yes.
So what they've done recently is they stopped that in 2013, I believe. So it's just a fixed 30-year amortization period. So of that, of our UAL that we, unfunded liability that we have 30-year amortizations for several layers of that amount.
Yes.
So that $82 million of unfunded liability has amortization periods that could be as early as 2013 to 2043, and then going forward. One thing that that CalPERS board did to help strengthen the whole entire system is beginning with the valuations that will be created in as of June 30th, 2019. Those valuation cycles will be 20 years instead of 30 years.
Okay.
And it will be basically a flat number, as just like a mortgage is a fixed rate mortgage is a flat number. The amortizations right now, as it was alluded to, are based on expected salary growth.
Yes.
And part of that salary growth is basically a 3% inflator across the whole entire state. So they're using assumptions that are statewide. That creates a mechanism where at this point in time, we're not even paying enough to pay down some of that obligation.
Catch up. Yeah.
So that
goes to the second part of my question, the flow. As far as creating pension liabilities on a yearly basis, how much is the city accruing in service cost and interest on the debt and retroactive accruals? And finally, how much is it earning on its assets?
This past year, the CalPERS system earned 8.2%, which has not been included in an evaluation yet. It will be included in the 2018 valuations. In 2017, the return on assets was 11.2%, which both exceed the 7% return that they're expecting every year.
Yeah.
So that's one of your questions. The retroactivity of that, Jim had mentioned that you're kind of alluding to, is when we stopped putting people into our classic pension in 2011. So anybody who comes on board from now on that is a PEPR, that is a CalPERS member, will come into a plan that's less costly to the city and has less benefits for the employee when they retire. It's actually pretty close to what our plan is, as long as you retire around 62 or 63. Since 2013, all new employees who have not been a member of PERS before are in what are called PEPR members, and PEPR is an acronym that stands for the law that provided for, well, I'm telling everybody else because—
Trying to make sure everyone understands.
I'm sorry.
So in 2011, the state passed a law that changed a lot of ways that pensions are provided. And one of those is that for miscellaneous members, it's a 2% S62 plan. That means for every year of service, you get 2% as long as you retire at 60. So that has helped us stop the bleeding, because we don't have anybody who's on our classic tier one plan anymore, except for the people that are already in the plan or have already retired between roughly 2000 and now. I'm not sure how to say this, but the one certainty that we know of is by 2047, the people that are in our original tiers will probably age out of the system.
Okay.
So we'll have more people that are, and we are continuing to add more people into the second and third tiers, which help us work on that from a point of view of long-term savings, but as long-term savings, the increases that CalPERS has put on us are there to help maintain the system overall. One thing that they're concerned with is if we do have a recession in 2019, the stock market will probably go down. The funding level that we have of 70% could go down. Most experts say that if a pension plan goes below 50% funded, it's kind of in a cycle that it can't get out of. Yeah, so they're trying to avoid that at all costs. And they have about a 10-year window where they figure in about 10 years they will have avoided most of the risks that could cause it going under 50%. So that's why they're trying to do these incremental fixes that will help stabilize the system now rather than just waiting down the road.
So the most basic question, how much does the city of Lompoc accrue every year in service costs as far as the pension funding goes?
Well, they're looking too, I was gonna throw out to Dean too. Didn't you had a number that if we were to double up on our payments, there was a savings that would really shorten the life of our liabilities. Do you remember that one?
Yeah, CalPERS came out with, well, they've always had the 30-year, but they've started to come out with, because a lot of cities are trying to pay that debt down faster, a 10-year amortization. And I don't know the total cost, but I knew that the cost of the general fund was around $750,000. It's the same thing if you were to get off that 30-year amortization and get in the 15-year for the public safety. They have another schedule out, and it's about the same amount. But that would just be and I'm doing net costing again on that $750,000 on the general fund side. So about $1.5 million.
Additional to what?
My question is get off that. How much in pensions are we accruing per year? Service costs, just net.
So we have two different plans. One's for the miscellaneous group, which is non-safety, and one for safety. Because they're two different plans, they're reported differently, separately in our financial statements. So for the miscellaneous plan, in the 16-17 year, with a measurement date of 15-16 because of how GASB 68,
yes.
We had $2.8 million of service
Excellent.
Added to our liabilities.
Okay. For that tier and for the other tier?
Well, that's for all tiers within miscellaneous.
Tiers. Okay.
And looking for the safety side.
Okay.
Can you find it?
While they're looking that up, I will let the general public know that when CalPERS manages our funds, they don't take Lompoc's funds and manage it separately from, say, Santa Maria's funds or Sacramento's funds. They take all the funds from all the cities and put them into a single fund and manage it. So unlike where you have maybe your own 401k and you get to choose and manage your funds, even if you're with a company and you get to manage your own pool, we don't have that option as a city. So again, it's managed as a very large pool of money from multiple municipalities and counties to play with. And unfortunately, if it affects all of us because all our monies are applied in the same way to the different stocks and bonds.
Mayor, if I may, if they're having a hard time finding this, it might be we can come back and get it for you just so we can get more people.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Good morning, Honorable Mayor, City Council, City of Lompoc. You probably should have had a clock. I might be here for a while. No, I won't be that long. This morning, and on several occasions, we hear about the problems with the budget of Lompoc. And rightly so, we need to hear it. But we don't hear a lot of solutions. We keep hearing a lot of the same things that have been going on for decades, for years. I wrote down several points. My first point is a question for not only you, but for our whole city. My question is, why isn't Lompoc the jewel of Santa Barbara County? We've got a base that's over there, Vandenberg Air Force Base, that has companies on it that are multi-billion dollar companies, and we don't tap into that resource. It makes no sense to me whatsoever. We are sending people to Santa Barbara to work for some of those companies. We are sending people to Santa Maria, we send people to the base, and yet those entities could be right here in this city. Tesla, for instance, could be right here in Lompoc. NASA could be right here in Lompoc. NASA got a $19.5 billion award signed by President Trump. It's there. Tesla, Elon Musk said that he wasn't impressed with that because it meant now Tesla and NASA have to compete against each other. Well, guess what? We can have them competing against each other right here in Lompoc. But we got to talk to them to do that. My second point, we'll come back to that. We talked about low-income housing. We talked about 30% of the housing in Lompoc is for low-income housing. That means we have low-income families. That means we have children who are coming up in low-income families. If we don't bring education here that will allow them to come out of that cycle, we will continue to have 30% low-income education for those kids because they can't afford the higher education. That means that if you bring Tesla and NASA and other companies like that here to Lompoc, we can build trade schools. We can have schools that teach them what they need to learn to be able to work on that Air Force base, or for Tesla that builds a company here or a plant here. I don't know if any of you have seen that Tesla plant that's up in Oakland. It's huge, it's amazing, but we should have that right here, or something like that that prepares them to work for Tesla or for NASA. On my job, I work for United Way AmeriCorps Home for Good, which was mentioned earlier. Part of my job is seeking funding sources. I don't know if you realize it, but Comcast has an agreement with veterans associations, and I spoke last week with a retired brigadier general. Her name is Carol Eggerts. She's the senior vice president for military and veterans affairs at Comcast NBC United. They had a program, a veterans initiative, that said they wanted to hire 10,000 veterans by 2020. Did you know that? Do you know that they've now increased that plan to 21,000 veterans by 2021? We should be talking to Comcast about building a training facility here so that when they train these veterans to come to work for NASA, those veterans that come off of that base that retire or that come out of the military early, stay here. That's another income source that would be here. That's another training opportunity, not only for the veterans, but for our youth that are growing up here. Too many of our kids graduate from our high school and have to leave here in order to get their lives started. We've heard the future of Lompoc mentioned several times. We heard about a 20 to 30 year plan. We just mentioned 2047. You know, we look around this room, and most of you, I'll include myself, most of us won't be here in the next 30 to 40 years. My father lived to 78. My uncle lived to 90. 78 is 18 years for me. We're talking 20 to 30 years. We've got to do something now that secures Lompoc's future for our kids coming up. To finish what my points here, Elon Musk and Tesla has a Mission to Mars plan. Now, when we hear that term, a lot of times we, you know, those of us who are a little bit older, a lot of times we hear Mission to Mars and we think, that's way out there somewhere. But you know, those of us who hear that grew up watching Star Trek, and they used to flip a phone, you know, or a communicator out like that, right? And they, Spock, beam me up. Well, now we all have these phones that are so much more technologically advanced that it's a real thing. This Mission to Mars, there's a program that's on TV that comes on every week, Mission to Mars. And it's funded by Tesla, but it's being shot someplace else. But the doggone missions that are being done to get ready for that are launched from Vandenberg Air Force Base. We're not a part of it. That's crazy. This is a real thing. This is billions of dollars for a dream to go to Mars, but that dream has billions of dollars behind it, and we're not tapping into it. It just does. We got to start thinking outside of Lompoc. Lompoc is a very beautiful little valley. But you saw what happened in Thousand Oaks when those fires started sweeping through there. This place could be wiped out in a hurry if we don't start looking at ways to look outside of Lompoc. And it could benefit all of us. You know, we got to stop looking at little things that are going to benefit a few people in Lompoc. I'm sorry, I'm going to say it, but a racetrack, it only benefits a few people in Lompoc. It doesn't benefit all of us. Education benefits all of us. And we have ways of getting it here. That the public safety facility, I was part of the team that went over and talked to Allen Hancock College to get it brought here. In fact, I was the last speaker, and I've been a friend of the president of that college ever since. We can do this. I will be talking to Carol Eggert, the Brigadier General from Comcast, next week. I talked to her last week. She told me to get back to her because they were getting ready for the Army-Navy game. She said, I'll be back on the 13th of December. Call me, email me, we'll talk then. So I'm going to be talking to her next week about what they're going to do with Comcast and those 21,000 jobs. Now, my office is in Santa Maria. I could talk to her about coming to Santa Maria, or I can talk to her to coming to Lompoc where I live. I would much rather see her come to Lompoc. Elon Musk, I'm going to try to get a hold of him. If I don't talk to him, I'll talk to somebody from Tesla to get him to come here. We shouldn't be talking to his representatives. We should have a briefing from Elon Musk. We got to start thinking bigger to make Lompoc better. We got to do it. I don't have a lot of questions for you. I just got a lot of solutions.
Thank you.
Good morning. Good morning. My name is Ron Fink, and I live here in the city of Lompoc. And it's clear from the discussions earlier that you all are going to have to establish some priorities in your budget. I didn't hear one mention of the Constitution of the City of Lompoc, which is the general plan. I would urge the city staff to probably educate you or advise you as to what some of the requirements are that you certified in the general plan. These are the shall statements, and I'll read a couple of them from the public safety section of the general plan. The city shall provide emergency medical response, including advanced and basic life support as defined in Title 22 of the California Code of Regulations. Okay, you shall do that, all right? If a person has a heart attack, they have about 6 to 8 minutes of golden time where they can be saved. You need to assure that your emergency services are able to arrive at that person's side within that period of time. Your fire chief can help you out with that. Prior to the implementation of the rescue crew, you were unable to answer 500 calls a year because of what was called overlap. Both units were busy, therefore the call went unanswered until they came back in service again. Okay, the second component of that is the OSHA required two-in, two-out rule. This means that if you wear a breathing apparatus and enter an immediately dangerous to life and health situation, which is a fire, you have to have two rescuers outside to rescue the person that's inside in case they go down. That's what the rescue crew does. So that means that the engine can go to work once that rescue crew arrives and begin the work of putting the fire out and saving people in the building. They can't go to work till they have the two out. The second concerns the police department. The general plan says, the police department shall seek to maintain a 3-minute average response time for all emergency service calls within the city limits. The police chief could help you understand how many times they meet that goal. The second part is the police department shall undertake special efforts to deal with high crime rate areas in key areas. Council District 2 is one of the most violent areas of the city, including commercial and so forth and so on. So basically what I'm saying is go to the general plan, have the staff tell you what you've all agreed that you shall fund. Then if you have anything left over after that, you can spend it on something else. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm Kathy Howard. A year or so ago, a plan was submitted to put before the voters a sales tax of, I think, 0.5%. I'm suggesting that maybe the citizens of Lompoc are smart enough to know whether they want that or not, and you might consider that as an additional source of revenue. I think I'm certainly smart enough to consider it, and you all could make the case to Lompoc that it's needed.
Thank you.
Good morning. I think it is still the morning. I'm Judy McKinnon, a 40-year resident, and I have questions that are a lot closer to home. One is that I'm pretty sure the city has applied for an emergency grant to help deal with the homeless population in the riverbed, and I'm wondering if that happened, and if so, what's the status? Don't need an answer today, but just asking.
Okay.
Number two, I keep hearing that we have been required to have 30% of the homeless housing in Lompoc. Was that LAFCO who made that consideration? Was that the state who put that burden on us?
That wasn't a requirement put on us. What has happened is we have ended up with 30% of the population.
Okay. What we need to do is find a legal way, even if it means a lawsuit, to recover property taxes that we are out because we are carrying that burden for the rest of the cities in this county. Third, again, Mr. Fink is talking about police coverage, and I am appalled that there are 11 vacancies. And one thing that I have noticed over a long period of time, I know that they got a little salary increase last time around, but Lompoc for years has been spending money to recruit, vet, and train police officers who then go to Santa Maria or elsewhere who pay a little more. Why have we ever looked at the cost of that turnover? And is there a way for us to legally require that when we put that kind of investment on a new police officer, he or she is required to stay here and work in the city of Lompoc for some agreed length of time? Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello, City Council and everyone from the city staff. There's no easy solution, obviously, to these challenges that we have in Lompoc. So I just wanted to list a couple things, just thoughts that I had personally. It's been mentioned that we want or need more development in Lompoc. That's like should go without saying. But then we also have to ask the question, what is the incentive for people to come here and develop? Are the amenities where they should be? When you go on Zillow and you see schools at a certain percentage, is that an attraction? Is there a reason people should want to come here to develop a business? Housing, I thought about the numbers and I learned a lot. Thanks for sharing all of the property tax stuff. We definitely need housing, but that's, if we were to say, and my numbers could totally be wrong, but if we had 1,000 houses at 350 grand come online next year, that's 16% of that 1%. At least just those property taxes worked out to about a little under 600 grand. I could be way wrong, so correct me quickly if I'm way out there, but that's not going to be a Band-Aid fix anytime soon. So we can't look at that as the excuse for why we can't fix something. Someone just mentioned the 30% low income or Section 8 stuff. That's not going to go from 30 to 15 or 30 to 10 or 30 to 20 anytime soon, and we all know that. So we can't necessarily use that as a scapegoat as to why we can't fix something. Some people think maybe wages at the city are way too high, but this one of these slides here shows our wages at pretty much close to the bottom. So there's a couple considerations. You do, to a point, pay for what you get. If we have the lowest wages with our competing cities around us, why should we be surprised when we have people up and leave for a better opportunity? That seems reasonable. Vacancies, well, it's fine to look at keeping vacancies or maintaining vacancies as a way to perhaps balance something, but maybe another way to consider it is think of a really busy, crowded restaurant needs to service everybody, but instead of having a full staff, they decide to cut it in half, or they only have two servers on the floor. Well, we all know what happens. We all get upset. We don't get service. It takes forever. The quality of service declines. So just having vacancies is not necessarily a solution to bring our level of service up. So we really have to consider that. So those are just some of the issues. Again, there's no easy solution, but I had just a couple quick thoughts, and these are, I'll throw them out there and probably get some flack on some of them. But let's start with shopping local. A lot of us as citizens do have a role here. We haven't really quantified how Amazon has changed the game. We've talked for decades about how we go to Santa Maria and we shop. That's a big point too, but just remember every time that UPS drops something off at our door, it's potentially taking a little bit of revenue away from not only the state, but also locally. So remember to shop local. That's a big deal too. As far as Mr. Vega had mentioned something about the efficiency or the cost of some of the commissions and committees, some exciting possibilities that would actually affect the budget is at the EDC, we've invited the Parks Commission to come and talk to us about, you know, they're really getting into the weeds about analyzing our level of parks, the quality of parks, quantity of parks, perhaps looking at the efficiencies of the people on these committees and commissions that volunteer their time for free to come here and talk about and try to look for solutions that might benefit us. Just so you know, there are committees and commissions that are starting to collaborate. We all know that Lompoc has a huge challenge, so we're trying to put our heads together too to come up with some solutions. So look forward to talking with you about some of those. The last thing I'll say, and as somebody had mentioned this, but I'll elaborate on it, is sales tax. No one wants to afford it. No one wants to pay it. It's always bad news. I get it. But I'll be the first person to raise my hand that in a lot of situations, I drive to Santa Maria, and many of us do. And we spend our money there. I don't know how many of us know that they have an add-on tax. They have a sales tax. So if I from Lompoc drive to Santa Maria and I spend, and that's fine, a lot of it is necessity, but we are putting money in their sales tax coffers so that they can invest in downtown, they can maintain public service, they can do lots of great things for their community. And you see the rate of growth that they have. If a sales tax is going to put a quash on growth, that doesn't pan out in Santa Maria. Just for reference, Santa Maria has at least currently, I believe, has a quarter of 1% sales tax. And guess who has a 0.5% sales tax? These booming cities of Paso Robles, Rio Grande, Grover Beach, Morro Bay. So let's just consider, like, it's going to take a balanced approach. We can cut where we can. We can be wise and efficient where we have to be. But we always have to remember it's important to invest in ourselves. And maybe the sales tax isn't the perfect solution, but maybe it should be a part of the conversation if we want to maintain services at a certain level and public safety. Just a few thoughts. I look forward to having a conversation with all of you as we try to tackle these very challenging issues. Thank you.
Thank you. We're coming up on our noon deadline, but if council so desires to continue hearing public comment for another 15, 20 minutes? Okay.
Okay, may I speak?
Yes.
My name is Justin Rouget, and I'm a 25-year resident here in Lompoc. And we're here today to discuss the budget that we've been discussing for the last 3 or 4 years as a group. And the big elephant in the room is and has been CalPERS. They've stuck us with a big bill. We cannot ignore $70 billion. Is our bill. All the other cities have gotten their bill. What have the other cities done to help pay for this bill? They have passed sales tax. All around us, the cities have passed sales tax. And the voters see the reason for it and they vote for it. The only city that hasn't done this is this city. And this guy here and this guy here have opposed doing it. And they don't think the people will vote for it. Give them a chance. The only way we're going to manage our budget with a $70 billion debt is to pass the sales tax. Otherwise, what are we gonna do? We're gonna close this darn place. We're gonna lay everybody off. There's not gonna be any services here in this town. And that's what these guys are doing. Cut, cut, cut. You see the police, we're way understaffed. That's why. We need to give the people in this town a chance to pay, to vote for a sales tax, to solve the problem, which is CalPERS. It isn't our problem. It's given to us by the state. And everybody else has got the same problem. And the only way we're going to solve it is by this other infusion of money through a sales tax. And it's not going to hurt us. Everybody else has done it, and it hasn't hurt their business one bit. But if you put it on the ballot here as soon as you can, like next year, you've got to get up there and say, hey, we need this. We want your support. Please pass it. The two big bonds that we passed here for schools and for the hospital a few years ago would never have passed if everybody hadn't got up and say, hey, we need it. And so the city council here, if you're going to vote to have a sales tax, which I hope you will, then you need to stand up and say, here's why and here's how. And we're showing right here this morning why we need it. This budget review shows clearly why we need it. So please give it a thought. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello, City Council, Mayor. My name is Gilda Cordova. As you guys know, I operate and I was in part of the development of the Hilton Garden Inn here in Lompoc. I also serve on Explore Lompoc, the Tourism Business Improvement District. And I just want to say that I think a lot of people in Lompoc, or everyone in Lompoc, has their own idea of what Lompoc is or what they think Lompoc is. Serving on Explore Lompoc, it really drives me to want to push and break down barriers when it comes to the image of Lompoc and what Lompoc has to offer. In January, I identified that Vandenberg Air Force Base was going to have a mission to Mars, and when I came to certain committee meetings that I serve on, nobody knew about that mission, or we weren't in tune as a city as to what is going on. And as the gentleman said earlier, we have a great, great opportunity to partner. And I know that the work that has been done by the individuals that have done it in the past to be liaisons and partner with Vandenberg Air Force Base, but there's more work that needs to be done. There's a harder opportunity for presence before Vandenberg Air Force Base. I was just recently, 2 weeks ago, seated with Colonel Huff at the Western Range Operations Command Center, and we were talking about his dream of having California ultimately adopt Vandenberg Air Force Base the way that Florida adopted Cape Canaveral. And I know that he's suggested that maybe perhaps to many of you guys when he sat with you, but I think that if we put the pressure on and we actually go out there and we market ourselves as a community that supports mission, you know, the Vandenberg Air Force Base mission, I think that we will open and break down barriers and doors with SpaceX, with NASA, with all these subcontracting agencies. Now, I know a lot of them can't necessarily be in Lompoc. A lot of them have to be on base. But guess what? Last night, there was over 500 people that came through the Hilton Garden Inn as visitors. And when we partner with these agencies, whether it's through Hilton Garden Inn or Explore Lompoc, and we give them that Explore Lompoc bag that tells them, hey, whenever you're back in the area, thank you for coming, first of all, but whenever you're back in the area, make sure that you come out and you skydive or bring your vacation time here and spend your money here, because we have golf, you know, we have the arts, we have murals, we have so many things to offer tourism-wise, and the wine industry, of course. But what I'm saying is that we have the opportunity to get front and center with a lot of these visitors. Mission to Mars, it drew in. Once we got everybody together and we all worked as a community to welcome these people, we had over 5,000 people. The base's number actually estimated over 6,000 people in the area. And so we have the opportunity to do that. Historical launches are happening. That's just one thing. When we talk about, you know, development, you have to consider, you know, the cost of development today, you know, and how are those people going to get their return? Whether you're talking about cost of building materials or cost of construction or even shortage in labor in California. Had we not taken, as they say, you know, the bull by the horns with the development of the Hilton Garden Inn, we were so short-handed in finding people, individuals, that it was very hard to come across. So I know that there's challenges even in those industries, and we have to be mindful of that. But I just want to say that Lompoc has a great opportunity, and I think that if people actually come together and they want and are committed to serving this community, I think that we can make some huge strides in the next 2 to 3 years and make Lompoc a different destination all around for business, for tourism, for real estate, for so many opportunities that we can tap into. Thank you.
Thank you.
First, I want to say this was an outstanding presentation. It's what's been lacking for the last 4 years. This council has gone forward for 4 years with 20% of the information. And as a result of that, our reserves have fallen from somewhere around $7.5 million to somewhere around $3.5 million, which means that over the course of that, about $4 million was spent, greater than what we took in. And I just learned today that we borrowed a couple million dollars from the insurance fund, or we took back some money that perhaps shouldn't have been put there. But so now what you're facing is the fact that Mr. Troop's predecessor spent $6 million he didn't have. And that's part of the battle. A number of speakers have said, well, let's have a tax increase. I would point out to you that the last time we tried to have a tax increase for public safety, the community voted it down. This year we had proposals for tax increases for the kids, the school district, that was voted down. For Hancock, that was voted down. And for the two of you that were running for council, you said no tax increases and you were elected by wide margins. So I think the community has probably spoken on that subject, and it's time to get to work on what we really need to do. Brad, and I know you're better on this number than I am, but I think everybody in the audience needs to know what happened back in, it was either 2002 or 2004 when we fattened up the pension plan. And I think at that time we were 110% funded with CalPERS. Can you just, and I think the liability we incurred was about $5 million. Can you freshen that up a little bit for everybody?
I think the only thing I do know that the miscellaneous plan was over 100% funded, but I don't know exactly when it was. And the valuations that were done to get to that point, the only ones I have are the annual valuation. So I don't know what the analysis that was done when that was put into place in 2004. So
basically CalPERS said to the city, hey, in 2004, you're more than 100% funded. You could provide a better benefit package. And the council bought in on that, and it was all good. And we accrued, I think it was $5.4 million, but I wouldn't swear to it. And everybody said, well, you know, the revenue stream is great, and we can pay this back over 10 years, and life will all be good in the hood. And then 2008 happened, and that didn't work out. So part of the problem that we have today was based on advice that CalPERS gave the council, and the council acted on in good faith. Janelle, I think you mentioned your work with Home for Good. Do you think there's any possibility that you guys could leverage the state to take some action to get the county to give us some land?
It's being discussed.
Fantastic. Because that's a big problem for Lompoc. You know, there's a lot of discussion about how successful Santa Maria is. And part of that success is that they were able to annex 500 acres a couple of years ago. And they already had land they hadn't built on when they annexed that. We haven't been able to annex 5 acres. The project for the Bailey Corridor began in 2002, so 16 years later, a lot has been said, more than $1 million has been spent on development, and nothing has happened. On the income side, I would say that there are two things that we need to look for as a community that would have an immediate impact. You know, the Hilton Garden Inn was a huge gain for us, and based on the numbers that I've seen, they're going to deliver approximately $1 million in sales tax and bed tax, which certainly helped our budget. The sale of Lompoc Honda to a new owner who has dramatically increased sales blew up our sales tax when we needed it most. There is a car dealer who has repeatedly looked for a location in Lompoc, and I think we need to embrace that individual and try to help them find a place here and even offer them an incentive if we need to, knowing what the sales tax will be from a car dealership going forward. The hotels in Lompoc are now approaching full occupancy again, and it's time to begin seeking out a hotel company that we'll build here. We have four good sites. I would be delighted to work with anyone that wants to help with that. Shop Lompoc. There's a council resolution that Councilmember and Starbuck and I worked on that outlined an entire Shop Lompoc program that was going to cost, I don't know, what was it, Dirk? $5,000, $6,000, I mean, something so insignificant. But the staff didn't like it, so it was never implemented. Now, the council passed it, so you could implement it the day after tomorrow. You already have the mandate. I would hope you would look at that. I jotted down a list of things that we could reduce, and I'll talk about that individually with you later. But one of the things that I learned going to League of Cities was something called a volunteer coordinator. And I have a file on it, and I have the contact information for a lady in San Diego who was tremendously impressive. She generates $1.3 million a year in free labor for her city on a $60,000 budget. I think that's a pretty good trade, and I would hope we would look at that. We find ourselves in this position because some very poor decisions were made by Mr. Weimiller in bringing you budgets. And you'll recall that I stood up here before you. No, you have your own opinion. That's fine.
I'm sorry, there is no booing, there is no clapping. And I, again, to the speaker, I think we want to move forward and not lay blame at feet. So I'd also ask you to refrain from too much blaming as well as part of your comments.
No problem.
Thank you.
So we find ourselves in this position today, and we can't fix the past. You know, that's been very clear. We can fix the future by bringing in large revenue generators in a short period of time, and we are going to have to reduce some costs along the way. So it's upon all of you to look at those costs and decide which things are least vital to the residents of Lompoc. Clearly, public safety is the more vital side, and that is what cities were created for. Cities were originally created for fire departments and police departments. Everything else is on the table. Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Gotta lower that. He's way taller than I am. So, we've heard a lot of comments about the need to grow, the need to expand business, the need to partner, but there's one big problem, and maybe it's not a big problem, but it's a great obstacle, is that we are not through completely with our general plan, but unfortunately there are some elements that have been incorporated into the general plan that are going to prevent the expansion, the development, and the growth of the town. We've embraced a agricultural protectionism methodology within the general plan. And if you go back in history and you look back in the past, as these projects, people keep asking why projects don't move forward, as these projects became closer to fruition, because of the way the general plan was worded or because of absence of certain elements in the general plan, outside agencies, there's one law firm came in and litigated the city for violations of the general plan. So I think one of the big priorities that you need to do is, as you're creating this vision, you need to go immediately back. You're allowed to make up to 4 amendments to the general plan each year and correct those general plan elements that are going to be later used to litigate you and to stop all the progress that you're going to try to make. I think it's really important. We seem to have 2 factions in this town, and they're both on opposite extremes, that somehow that those that are in favor of the farm preservation methodology and those that are in favor of growth come together and figure out some type of balancing act in which we can preserve some farming still, but let the town grow a little bit. But until you address that core element in the general plan, nothing will happen to expand that will not be litigated and stopped. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi.
council members, mayor. Question, does the cannabis tax go into the general fund?
Yes.
And has anyone done any kind of study about how much we're projecting that might eventually raise?
We have a consultant that had predicted, and I don't remember the exact number. Does any of the staff? It's like $120,000 to $300,000.
Yeah, the amounts were on the ballot language, right. Yeah. And I don't remember what was, but that's the general.
General window, and it doesn't go into effect until they actually open and start doing business and paying the tax, so.
All right, well.
At this point, after they have their permit to be a permitted cannabis business, they still then have to go through the normal process of going through the building department and opening up and getting their certificate of occupancy and doing all of those things. So we're eager to assist them if they're ready to move forward now that some of them already have their cannabis permits. Yes, sir.
Just a quick update. I had an email today, or is it yesterday, from the people who are planning to go into the old Blacksmith restaurant. Mm-hmm. They've already received back their, because we sent out, if you recall, we had a meeting where council approved doing a letter that we could send up that's saying, yes, they're in the process and whatnot. And they got their letter back from the state already. So that was a day or so ago. So it is moving forward.
It's a whole new world learning all of the ins and outs between us and the state. So we thank everyone's patience for us learning it and also respecting what the state requires us to do. I really want to thank everyone for coming out this morning. It's been, I think, really valuable for not only us to learn where changes have been made by the staff, where they have worked really hard to improve the information being provided to us to be more accurate. So first of all, thank you to the staff for all of the hard work, the many, many weeks you've been putting into this. Thank you to the staff that has promoted this. It's been really important. I think the turnout was here really well, not just because council was announcing it, but our social media was really strong. The message was put out through both the modern form and the traditional form of, you know, news and newspapers. And then last but not least, to the staff that showed up today to support any of these questions being asked and being present, because I know it took away from your weekend during the holiday season. Then there's the community. You showing up today really shows that you love this community and you want it to survive and you want it to improve. And that's our goal as a whole. Maybe we each have a different approach to it and we have a different desire as to how we should see that implemented. But our goal is to work as a whole and improve our community and do it in a way that lifts everyone up, not one particular industry or one particular person, but lifts our entire community. And we are a jewel and we all know it. We just need to buff it and polish it a little bit more and start telling everyone that we are an amazing community and that you really will be welcomed here, and we wrap our arms around and make you Lompoc. Lompoc is our priority. And once you're here, you're part of our family. Last but not least, continue to come to the meetings. Come to the regular council meetings. Volunteer for a committee or commission. Meet with staff that you have questions for. Bring your ideas forward. Keep attending these special workshops. We're going to continue informing you and doing a better job. And to my fellow council members, thank you for taking time on your Saturday to show the public that this is important information, that we do want to be transparent, and that it's really important for us to tackle this together, not just us, but us as a community. Thank you, and we are adjourned.